Hello? Check, check. Check, check. There's a volume, Carla. There's a volume on the speakers.
The speakers themselves.
Check, check.
Hey, I heard myself. Hello, New York.
Hello, New York.
Are you guys receiving the stream there?
Yes, we can see you guys very well.
Yeah, okay.
Very specific speakers.
Do you
just this?
Ready to start?
Yeah, is everyone there? Is Elizabeth there and Bruce there?
Yes. Yes.
Greetings.
All right, so
greetings.
Hey guys.
Hi, Elizabeth.
Hey, Elizabeth.
Hello, hello. You guys hear me? No. So this mic. We're gonna try to get the room mic going.
Okay.
Hello, hello. How's that? Great. You got a room mic going. So, Carla.
Okay.
Do you need to be like this? No, we shouldn't have this. Just minimize it so. Oh, you want to minimize it so that it's not blocking up.
That's okay. You could maximize it if you need to.
You can minimize it.
Yeah. Elizabeth.
Hey, Elizabeth.
You've got an image up on the screen behind you or next to you, and it says, it's a quote from H.G. Wells, and it says, "The history of humanity has always been a race between learning and disaster." That's going to be the background for a couple of introductory remarks I'd like to offer tonight, and start by saying good evening. My name is Elizabeth Ellsworth. I'm Associate Provost for Curriculum and Learning here at the New School and also Professor of Media Studies. Tonight, I'm very honored to welcome you on behalf of the Provost's Office to the first event of Design and Existential Risk, a series of 9 lecture events that will run from now until December 9th. Design and Existential Risk is supported by the Dean's Office, Parsons, the New School for Design. It's been conceived and coordinated by Ed Keller. We are most proud and excited to now have the school as the new Associate Dean for Learning and Technology at Parsons and Associate Professor of Design Strategies. Ed brings to his work and to the composition of this series a deep grasp of what is at stake in being a human runner in the race between learning and disaster, especially at this moment in history. And this is precisely where the Design and Existential Risk series of events locates us as its participants in the time and space between learning and disaster. What will we do here? What will we make this space and time between what is beyond our knowing and what we now sense coming upon us? Even as the speeds accelerate, even as the distance closes. The wager of design and existential risk is that design might give us an edge. It's a practice of deep engagement with the brute materiality of the external world. That's why we suspect that design might know something about how we might navigate the increasingly precarious course that we are now running. If escape from living under the sign of disaster is impossible, what sort of life is possible here? In recent art form, Emma Levine offers a suggestion. She says, we can perhaps pursue a kind of wobbly balancing act, seeking moments of fleeting equilibrium, when we can gracefully parry the forces that act upon us. Gracefully parrying the forces that act on us. Not a bad definition of design, perhaps. Maybe not a bad definition of the challenge that faces us higher education in the 21st century. That challenge to design places and times where we can gracefully and responsibly carry the force of learning while on the go. Those are the kinds of learning environments that we seek to design, build, and activate as students and as faculty here at the new school. And that is why I'm so pleased to introduce Design and Existential Risk and Ed Keller. Thank you for being here today.
Can you folks hear us? Okay, Elizabeth, thank you very much for that introduction. And I'm delighted that we have such an extraordinary roster of people who are going to be joining us for the events that we have scheduled for the fall. I want to thank the Dean's Office and Joel Towers for supporting the event. I also want to thank a number of people within the Dean's Office who've been instrumental in making this happen, coordination and implementation. Mary McGraw has been tremendous in getting everything going. Chris Ahn, Jennifer Ree, Chris Rivera, Mike Edwards, everyone has been doing a great job in getting this up and going. So thank you very much to everyone. I guess what I'd like to do is read you a brief quote from J.G. Ballard to set the tone of what I think might be at stake in this topic, in the topic of design and existential risk. This is from a novel by Ballard called The Drowned World. He said in this novel, "These are the oldest memories on Earth, the time codes carried in every chromosome and gene. Every step we've taken in our evolution is a milestone inscribed with organic memories, from the enzymes controlling the carbon dioxide cycle to the organization of the brachial plexus and the nerve pathways of the pyramid cells in the midbrain. Each is a record of 1,000 decisions taken in the face of a sudden physico-chemical crisis. Just as psychoanalysis reconstructs the original traumatic situation in order to release the repressed material, so we are now being plunged back into the archaeopsychic past, uncovering the ancient taboos and drives that have been dormant for epochs. The brief span of an individual life is misleading. Each one of us is as old as the entire biological kingdom, and our blood streams are tributaries of the great sea of its total memory. The uterine odyssey of the growing fetus recapitulates the entire evolutionary past, and its central nervous system is a coded timescale, each nexus of neurons in each spinal level marking a symbolic station, a unit of neuronic time." And again, that was Ballard in The Drowned World, 1965. This is, for me, a great quote because it talks about exactly what we have incredible difficulty in doing. We have difficulty in perceiving those scales of time. And design has to accept the challenge that it's a fundamental epistemological limit to perceive those kinds of scales of time. So that's the kind of impulse that has driven us to convene this conference and to invite the people that we've invited, starting today with Bruce Sterling and with Geoff Manaugh. So with that brief introduction, I'd like to turn it over to Carla Leitao to introduce Bruce. Carla is an architect and professor. She's my partner in AUM Studio, a partner in crime in our design firm and research firm, and she's a professor at Rensselaer Polytechnic and at Pratt Institute in architecture.
When Bruce Sterling dropped the bomb name Spine in 2004 and later put it in print in the 2005 publication Shaping Things, the concept resonated across a vast horizon of fields of practice that spans industrial design all the way to augmented reality, passing the disciplines and niches that were as diverse as advanced object modeling and generative art, interactive technology, biotechnology, cultural studies, information and communication technologies, environmental sciences, and in general, all activities, endeavors that aspire to belong to the construction of the Internet of Things. Dr. Sterling has a successful career as a science fiction writer with series of soul makers, but also heartbreakers, such as the Schismatrix Plus, the collection and its shaper mechanist universe, being one of the main names of the cyberpunk movement in science fiction, along with William Gibson and Rudy Rucker, among others. He has also been prolific as a producer of active archives and anthologies on the subject, His work, Meyer Shade's The Ecology, is considered the core representative piece of the genre. In the last two decades, Dr. Sterling has increasingly intertwined the components of near realistic reality in his work, traveling the world in its major thinking places as a visionary resident, futurologist, techno-advisor, or even what we would call a new emergent class, the media hyper-philosopher. Along the way, Dr. Sterling has gone from matrixes and their combinatory and intersecting sets in science fiction novels to stages in the future manifesto, Tomorrow Now, envisioning the next 50 years, to synchronicity in shaping things with intelligent objects and parts that communicate with each other, to contemporary inquiries on the atemporal, to the contemporary speed of succession of possible futures. Dr. Sterling may have added some acceleration by identifying processes and naming agents before they emerge into the technological or cultural scene, only to then come back while they're reigning and announce some new probable births. In his current Beyond Beyond blog, hosted at Wired magazine, there is an equal abundance of computer, network, and gadget culture at large, and design and augmented reality in particular. But also an increasing, permeating discussion on social, culture, political, and environmental issues regarding society's choices in the invention and uses of new technologies, mainly communication ones. Today, we are excited to have Dr. Sterling's insights on design and risk as a troublemaking brainstorming of the possible futures of this lecture series. Thank you very much for helping me welcome.
That was so poetic and beautiful. Thank you, Ed, for taking the trouble to ask me here to deal with all this transcontinental foofra. And, you know, we're crossing the continent here, and I'm very happy to see Geoff, a guy I have learned to call a colleague over the years, and someone whose thinking has helped me a lot when I dabble with architecture fiction. So, yeah, I'm a science fiction writer, just like my hallowed ancestors Wells and Ballard there. And I'm happy to be the like first guy to walk in the new fallen snow of your existential risk here. I am a science fiction writer, and our genre is dominated by wondrous and awesome spectacle. So we're very keen on ending the world and blowing stuff up. And it's kind of as knowledgeable about it as anybody is. And yeah, I have done that. I had a story recently that was written by my cyberpunk colleague, Dr. Rudy Rucker. He's a computer science professor, now retired from San Jose State. And Rudy is very knowledgeable about world-ending things, cosmic things, and so forth. So we wrote a story together called Colliding Brains, B-R-A-N-E-S, which was about a metaphysical or astrophysical theory that the universe is comprised of 12 dimensions and that something might go wrong with them. Which is a hilarious idea on the face of it. And the story is about two bloggers who somehow believe that something has gone wrong with the cosmic brains and that the entire cosmos is going to end. And they get together because they share this cult notion, and they basically talk like Tea Party enthusiasts, except even more so. And then at the end of the story, the universe does in fact end. So, I've had my fun with that kind of thing, and it's just it's a riff in our genre, like a wah-wah pedal on electric guitar. And, it's a fun thing to think about, and it's, the universe are blowing up the world, and we're really eye-catching and kind of fun. But, I'd like to get a little deeper into that in the sort of 20 minutes that we've got here, and, really talk about how people deal with the idea and reality of existential risk. And commonly, an obsession with existential risk is the sign of a totalitarian state. And it's part of a totalizing idea. And I'd like to explain how this works out in practice. Like, let's just say you're Imperial Japan, and you're a totalitarian state, and you keep upping the ante on your civil population as the war begins going more and more against you. You decide to start sacrificing young men as kamikazes because it's kind of an overwhelming moral gesture against the enemy, and that doesn't work. So now you decide to sacrifice the entire nation. The 40 million as a broken jewel theory, which means that every Japanese person has to die for the emperor, and they will end up as broken jewels instead of mere roof tiles. Right? Okay, now this kind of attitude immediately causes your enemies to sort of think, you know what? We've got some brainy guys out in the desert who like built like this giant incinerator bomb, and I think it's like time for us to like bring some serious shock and awe on these totalizers here. And then, in fact, you know, call up Stalin. It's like, so, Uncle Joe, we've got this extremely powerful mega weapon we've, like, built, and don't freak out or anything, but we're thinking about actually using it. And he's like, why? Who? Against the Japanese. Because, you know, they're like Iwo Jima, and otherwise we have to exterminate them all. Well, why don't you just go right ahead and do that? I mean, that'll be just fine. And that, in fact, happens. Is problematic because, in fact, your sort of willingness to embrace an apocalyptic tone within your society actually causes you to overawe you with exactly the topic that you are trying to move away. And there's a secret thread, or, you know, a kind of an underlying problem in American society that happened with this after 9/11, when Rumsfeld was the head of the Department of Defense. And people don't know this, but Rumsfeld is actually quite a well-known futurist. He worked at RAND, you know, for quite a while. And before 9/11, Rumsfeld had been involved in an existential risk exercise, you know, a futurist scenario involving unconventional atomic threats to the United States. And he had been involved in some scenario work in which people bring a tramp freighter into Washington Harbor and just detonate a nuclear weapon in the harbor and decapitate the entire United States government, simply turning Washington, D.C. into a plane of black glass. And this is not a hard thing to do. And after 9/11, when there was this attack on the Pentagon and, you know, an attack on New York City, Rumsfeld was, you know, involved in these briefs. He said, okay, they may very well have a weapon of mass destruction. And if they do, it's probably made out of yellow cake, and it's probably owned by the Iraqis. So, you know, in order to avert this massive existential threat against ourselves and the decapitation of the United States, we had better ignore the apparent pinprick of these terrorists and actually take out the guys who can build WMD. And this was the logic behind invading Iraq. Now, what's the upshot of this? Well, you know, it's kind of like dividing by zero. If you're actually seriously concerned that your government could be wiped out at any minute, you didn't have to sort of shelve the soft power option. Mr. President could just trump up whatever necessary scheme we need to do in order to make the thing happen that needs to happen. But the long shot of this, I mean, assuming that the existential risk does not occur, or that in fact there never was one, then you now have people like Brazilians sort of sitting around and saying, Americans seem extremely worried about socialism, and they're sort of becoming wilder. Well, we actually are socialists here, and we don't have any nuclear weapons, even though we're an emerging massive superpower. And I think maybe we better call up the Iranians on the phone instead of, you know, do a little diplomatic initiative here and see if we can't, like, actually engage in a little bit of nuclear proliferation. Because, you know, formerly we trusted them because they were sort of like democratic and were like working everything through sort of UN. But now that they're acting sort of weird, we kind of need to have some. And in fact, it would be better if like a bunch of guys got some, you know, because that way we wouldn't stand out ourselves. So you see the same logic playing out again. You're trying to avert a massive existential risk, and you end up provoking an actual increase in the probability that something will, in fact, go wrong. Now, if you're a science fiction writer, you don't want to do that. You want to concentrate on the really dramatic part where everything is at stake and, you know, sweaty fingers are inches away from the button, and that's easy to dramatize, but that's not how history actually works. And it's certainly not how catastrophe actually works. One of the best fictional descriptions of catastrophe, people ought to read this. It's really great. Red in the Black by Stendhal. Great writer, Stendhal. Even science fiction writers like him. There's a guy wandering around during Waterloo, and Waterloo is just occurring. And he really has no idea what's going on. I mean, just like this Italian guy on a horse, and people are like running back and forth, thorns and sticks and cannons are flying. Yeah, that's what a catastrophe is actually like. It's like wandering in the middle of a battlefield. And after any catastrophe, every catastrophe, it's just like series of orientations for something like 48 hours. People don't even know what has happened. They don't have words for what has happened. Like, what? Like, they're just really just trying to get a grip on it. And there's no way to make that any shorter, that 48-hour period. You can't design it away. And people on the ground are overwhelmed. They don't know what's happening. It's like, did the dikes break? Are we being attacked? Is the building on fire? Did something, is there a nuclear? Okay, it just takes 48 hours for that to happen. Then there's generally small responses by groups of people who sort of begin to get it together, and they sort of begin to attack aspects of the problem, like the building is on fire and there are kids in there. Okay, now we're like rallies and bring things in. And after 4 days, people have some understanding for what's going on. They sort of been able to verbally frame it. The hurricane has overwhelmed the dikes. That's the problem. That's where the water is. And all the big problems over here and so forth. And these things just can't go away. I mean, there's only so many ways to deal with a real catastrophe. And they really are catastrophic. And about the only thing we have to bring to the table there, I mean, people who are contemporary, is that we have more catastrophic technical failures than other people. We just have more technology. It's more powerful. There's more ways for it to go wrong. But the actual probability of catastrophe, not the same. I mean, less so maybe than the height of a Cold War. But, and they're slower, but they're still around. You know, and what does designers have to bring to the table here? Well, they design under conditions of catastrophe, but they're not distinct from the society. Like, Henry Dreyfuss, who designed the Situation Room for the Joint Chiefs of Staff. That's what you do when you're Henry Dreyfuss, like founder of industrial design. But we've got a problem here, Henry, and the nation is at risk. And we heard you were great, and you know, you can like build great office equipment. And we got like a bunch of Pentagon guys here, and they like really need like some cool office stuff. And you don't at that point then say, well, I'd like to intervene at a higher level, and then I'll communicate with my colleague Albert Speer, who's also a designer, and has some very interesting ideas about the theory of ruin value, and you know, we should like get together. And okay, you don't do that. You say, yes, sir. And you go to Washington, you build office equipment for the Joint Chiefs of Staff. And if you're Charles and Ray Eames, and you're like hanging out at Cranbrook and being very hip and, you know, messing with plywood, you build splints. You build splints for bomb victims. You don't build, like, beautiful chaise longs. It's like, their legs are blown off, Charles! And I was like, well, I think we'll like that. And I was like, what seems to be the design problem here? A lot of people with shattered limbs, Charles, Ray. Like, should I put polka dots on it? No. It's not about, you know, and that's what they did. And that was really their first hit. And they were not distinct by situation. There was no way to sort of get outside it and say, well, you know, this is a world war, and what we really need is more, you know, furniture made out of steel wires. That wasn't what they were allowed to do, and it wasn't really something they were going to do. And if you think, I mean, you need to, let me just offer the object lesson of East German design, which is a particular hang-up of mine. You know, I met a guy, he's an East German design critic. I'm a design critic, I'm not a designer, I never designed anything, I'm not really interested in doing it. I'm very interested in sort of how it works and what it can. East German design. Günter Hahner, East German design critic, I met this guy. He had like a traveling roadshow of the coolest East German design. I mean, not the coolest, because none of it is cool. It's all the products of a totalitarian society, but they're German people and really pretty good designers and sort of very Bauhaus, and they're like doing the whole minimalist thing, and they received an exquisite German technical design training. And had they been in West Germany, they could have done absolutely as much as Braun or, you know, these other kinds of German design firms. East German design firm, very well thought through, exquisitely detailed, disciplined German designers making the most horrible objects I've ever seen. I mean, really frightening I mean, more so than just vernacular ugliness or the kind of favela-style intervention poverty furniture that you would think of as bad. These guys are in a space. I mean, it's the, I don't like to call it the dark side of design, but it's sort of like, it's sort of, it, they, it bears the relationship to design that Scientology bears to science. That's how eerie it is, you know. And it was from them sort of personifying and sucking the ichor out of East German society and really trying to like meet the user needs of a totalitarian state. And you would not escape that were you in their situation. Do not be arrogant. Do not, you know, imagine that your skills and your training make you exempt from that, because they were as good as you. They were smarter than you. In some ways, they worked harder than you to a horrific, horrific end. How can I sum this up? I mean, there's a vice that is associated with existential risk, and it's not that it doesn't happen. I mean, the difficulty with science fiction is that, in some sense, it bears a message that is true, and the message that science fiction bears that is true is that the universe really is real. It really is real, you know, and there have been 5 episodes of massive existential risk on our planet, 5 gigantic extinctions. A couple of them happened apparently in the blink of an eye and just annihilated the planet. There were periods when the planet was almost frozen solid. And we're in the middle of a 6th great extinction. Geologically speaking, it's happening very quickly. So it's not like there are no existential risks. It's just that there are intellectual vices associated with confronting it. And we don't think about it very effectively, and we never have. We've always allowed a sense of wonder and the romance of embracing our own doom to distort what we do with it and to cause us to romanticize it and to fantasize about it and to sacramentalize it and to use it as a weapon of oppression against one another. I mean, human fate is melancholy. Pascal told us this 400 years ago. If you're born a human being, you're born in chains. Everybody's mortal. You're watching the older generation ahead of you get slaughtered. To be a human being is 100% fatal. I mean, that's a catastrophe, and people shrink away from that. I mean, they cannot intellectually confront it, and they invent entire series of you know, marvelous fantasies in order just sort of to get away from the fact that the human condition is in itself, a, you know, an existential disaster. And Wells did not escape this, although he claimed that, you know, it was all about education versus catastrophe. His last work is Mind at the End of Its Tether. When he's dying of liver cancer, he's just discovered the atomic bomb and says, I see no way out. Mankind is over. It's done. It's the year 1946. I have given up on my Fabian notions. I can no longer enlighten the masses. My visionary heir has failed me. And he was sick and he died. And he was at the end of his tether, because he was a mortal guy, but he was not telling the truth. The world did not end with the ending of H.G. Wells. He had merely internalized his own doom and his own weakness, and he tried to project it against everybody else as a sort of last look at me gasp of pundit wonderfulness. And nobody is exempt from that kind of egotistical invention. What could be done under these circumstances? I mean, what would be a positive thing for designers actually to do in a world that is confronted with existential risk? I think probably the coolest, most useful thing to do right now would be like set up a version of Geoff's building blog. But it's just ruined blog. Just kind of all ruin all the time, right? And just like try and set up this blog and just like do design fiction and really sort of tart it up, you know? Just do beautiful pictures of New York underwater, buildings on fire, bring your type of graphical skills on this, go hang out with people who are confronting this stuff, try and like use it as a communicative thing and just sort of like build it up, and then you have like a nice kind of internet locus of, you know, catastrophe design fiction. Because it is a fiction, it might happen, it's not actually happening. But we can certainly think about it better than we do. And we really need kind of the silo-melting, multidisciplinary approach, and just sort of like bring in a little of the old collective intelligence there, kind of like see if we can get a community around there, kind of a new sense of engagement. It wouldn't last forever. Believe me, catastrophes go through vogues. People who are really into catastrophe get bored with the catastrophe they usually, and they like wander easily to another catastrophe. But with any kind of luck, we might be able to like work our way out of our 20th century apocalyptic habits and actually kind of get a better and more sophisticated grip on the actual difficulties involved. Well, that's what I have to say. Thank you.
Can you folks hear? Okay. So thanks, Bruce. Hopefully we can work our way around the attention span limits that seem to be hard-coded into us. Let me introduce Geoff Manaugh, and hopefully Geoff can take us a little bit in that direction. So I'm really delighted that Geoff is joining us. I've been following his work for a number of years. We brought him down to SIARC a few years ago to do a lecture there. And last year we brought him into Parsons for our collective intelligence talks. Let me tell you a little bit about Geoff. He's the author of Building Blog, as I think probably everyone knows, and the Building Blog book. He was a former senior editor at Dwell, and he's a contributing editor at Wired. He's written for a number of publications, Volume, Domus, Abitare, Space and Culture, among many. And he's contributed to essays to books by photographers David Meisel and Michael Wolff. In 2009, Amazon chose Building Blog, the book, as one of their 100 best books. Along with Nicola Twilley, Geoff organized last year and co-curated the Landscapes of Quarantine Design Studio and Exhibition at New York Storefront for Art and Architecture. And this year, he's currently curating for 2011 an exhibition for the Nevada Museum of Art called Landscape Futures. As well as lecturing on a broad range of architectural topics at museums and universities, which run the gamut from the Bartlett School in England to Storefront for Art and Architecture to the Center for Land Use and Interpretation out here in Los Angeles, Geoff has taught design studios at Columbia University, Pratt, University of Technology, Sydney, and USC, and seminars. So I'm especially excited that he's joining us today because Geoff's insight in his writing on the role of speculation in architecture, science fiction, film, infrastructure, technology has been instrumental, I think, in helping us to reimagine possible futures. He's reached a really wide, dynamic global audience, and he's brought ideas which are actually very challenging and complex, which run up against that kind of attention span limit that Bruce was talking about. He's brought those ideas into an audience which wouldn't have had access to those ideas previously. So I'm really delighted that Geoff can join us today. Geoff.
Cool. Thanks, Ed. And thanks as well to Elizabeth and Carla for the introductions and hosting on the New York side, and Bruce as well. It's good to see you again, and I really enjoyed your talk. So I'm looking forward as well to our conversation after this when we get to the roundtable phase. And again, if there's any troubles with audio or anything like that, just let us know, and I can either speak up or for that matter, speak down. I think that what I wanted to do with my sort of brief time here speaking is look at the sort of the other side of not so much the design side of the conversation, but the existential risk, and think about what it really means to put oneself at risk and to be in a situation of existential risk. And I think specifically one of the things that I kept gravitating to while thinking about this was what I might call the idea of exposure, and exposing oneself to things that potentially pose a risk, but also potentially pose extreme and unparalleled benefit. And you know, what when you put this into the context or into the context of exposure, what exactly does it mean? How can one expose oneself beneficially, and what are the risks thereof? So there are several kind of subcategories, I think, that come up when talking about exposure. But one of the things that I think would be interesting is putting this in the context, not so much of extreme futurity, but even in terms of deep history and even archaeology and previous exposures of the human project to things that are inhuman or things that are even alien. And hopefully this will all wrap up towards the end of this kind of overview. But one of the things that I wanted to point out was there's a fascinating book that came out maybe about 10 years ago, and it's called The First Fossil Hunters. And it's about the project of looking for effectively inhuman life inside the Earth in the form of very large bones of inexplicable creatures that had not been seen otherwise by human beings. You find these at the origin of dragon mythology. You find this at the origin of Greek myths of giants and gods and titans. And at the same time, you also find this, of course, at the origins of paleontology and the science of bone collection and of fossilology and that sort of thing. So the book is really quite fascinating in the sense that it explores the sort of narrative implications of what it means when a human being encounters something that they don't understand at all, and that they have no prior knowledge of, and that they don't really have a conceptual model to understand. There's some really fantastic quotations that that I have written down. Some of the things she describes are the author is who is the author here? It's Adrienne Meyer. But she writes about striking personal experiences with giant skeletons that weathered out of the ground in Asia Minor. And she writes of landscapes where strange and immense skeletons emerge from the sand. She even refers to sort of how ancient fossil hunting got subsumed into science fiction narratives, both in the ancient mythology sense of science fiction and in the contemporary today sense of sci-fi, where the discovery of previously unknown ancient bones sort of posed an Earth that would be unrecognizable to humans, populated by creatures that we had never seen. So I mentioned that by way of, and there's a couple images that I wish I could show that show how sort of ancient Greeks would have understood the discovery of mammoth bones, for instance, putting them together so they looked like colossal human skeletons, and then coming up with myths of giants and titans to explain that away. But I mentioned that in the sense that if you were a fossil hunter in a time where you didn't understand what you were looking for, and it was really sort of before paleontology, so to speak, that there was a project of exposing oneself or seeking out the alien and seeking out the inhuman and looking for things that one would not understand. I think that obviously, you know, this continues today with things like the search for exobiology. And there was even a headline yesterday that I thought was quite extraordinary that basically geochemical smog on the Saturn's moon Titan could actually spontaneously create amino acids and the building blocks of life, which I think is a sort of a fascinating example of the becoming biological of the planetary and of something, you know, achieving what we would consider maybe a terrestrial or maybe even in religious terms something resigned to sort of the sphere of being pro-life, so to speak, but could actually spontaneously generate on other planets. So in any case, pursuing this line of exposure and deliberate exposure and seeking out the alien and seeking out the inhuman, I'm reminded of a quip by Bruce Mao, the designer, who's pointed out maybe 10, 15 years ago that perhaps the tourism of the future will be disease tourism, and that you'll actually be able to give yourself things like Ebola, smallpox, you know, any sort of untold, perhaps even anthrax and that sort of thing, in order to experience the ultimate and existential risk, but with the caveat that the cure, the antidote, is easily available, and one can inject oneself and come down from this kind of disease high or disease tourism. So the controlled exposure of oneself to risk in the sense of disease tourism or of seeking out the alien, I think is something that is an ongoing theme in what I would like to talk about today, but also in a subset of my own writing. And then also picking up on this idea of disease, I want to move to something that Bruce was mentioning, which is, you know, what happens if you discover the alien and instead of studying it, you weaponize it, so to speak, and you turn it into something that you can then use against fellow humans, and you can amp up the idea of risk and expose others to something that you've discovered. You know, it's not you can't take for granted that in the discovery of something that is radically inhuman, that it's going to result in just a bunch of papers in a philosophy journal, or that it's going to turn into some kind of scientific breakthrough. It could also turn into some sort of horrific weapon that is used against others. And history is ripe with examples of this. In medieval times, the famous example is using diseased corpses as effectively as artillery, and hurling them over the walls of enemy cities in order to spread pestilence into the population with which you were at war. But of course, we see it in today's things like germ warfare, bioterrorism, and even the anthrax scare of just after September 11th, with the anthrax-tainted envelopes sent around the media and to politicians. But I mention this because in one sort of particularly frightening example, a recent book that just came out is called The Dead Hand, and it's effectively a sort of insider's guide to the Soviet bioweapons and, basically the Soviet weapons programs of the Cold War. It focuses particularly on bioweapons, but it also looks at nuclear technology, and it's an incredibly disturbing book. It's the kind of thing that, even though it's effectively a history of the Cold War, I found it actually extremely hard to put down. But it points out the existence that had been previously unknown to the West, basically, until there was a defector who came to first Britain to share his stories with MI6. From the perspective of a scientist who had worked on bioweapons programs in the Soviet Union. But basically, in this sort of encounter with the inhuman, they had found a way of weaponizing things like everything from anthrax to Ebola to smallpox on colossal scale. And so there are some pretty fantastic, at the same time extremely terrifying, architectural descriptions of the mixing vats and the silos within which these, what the author describes of as anthrax slurries. This kind of massive mixing bowl that in some cases was, I'm forgetting the exact numbers, but, you know, was 30, 35, 40 feet tall of just a silo filled with anthrax slurry that could be loaded into individual warheads and spread, across enormous amounts of terrain. But so what comes out, and I think is what one of the eeriest aspects of the book actually is, even though it's a real behind-the-scenes tour of bioweapons and sort of world-ending weapons programs, is precisely where we don't know the full extent of what previously existed, which is to say what existed in the Soviet weapons program. And there are some descriptions that I find incredibly eerie, actually, where they can detect retrospectively from the timing of certain missile launches that something was designed in order to maybe spread anthrax through a low-flying cruise missile. Or the most stunning, I think, revelation of the book is what the title refers to, which is the Dead Hand. And the Dead Hand is actually a super weapon. It's a doomsday device that was built by the Soviet leadership. So as Bruce was describing, if you decapitate the leadership, if there was a first strike by the West that eliminated the Soviet government entirely, got rid of the generals, completely decapitated human leadership in the Soviet Union, the machines would take over, so to speak. And the Dead Hand is, when you hear it, it's actually really quite eerie. So basically all of the missiles in the Soviet Union would be wired up to receive transmissions to launch from a curtain of missiles that would be fired the minute they could no longer receive signals from human leadership. So if you annihilated the army and the generals and the prime minister and so on, or the supreme leader, the missiles would launch automatically upon detection of a severance of communication. But when the first wave of missiles were launched, they would be cruise missiles that would fly low over the landscape, sending out radio waves and signals to all of the other missiles and all of the other silos everywhere in the Soviet Union, all of which would then take that as a launch signal. And effectively, you'd have a war games-like launch of every single missile in the Soviet Union that would obliterate the enemy. It's quite accurately described as a doomsday device in the sense that it would effectively make life, at least in human terms, or what we recognize as life, impossible in a terrestrial sense if this kind of doomsday device were to be kicked off. So the themes that I want to be pointing out here then are the sort of the deliberate seeking of an encounter with the other or with the alien and with the inhuman. The possibility that that has for good in the sense of scientific advancement and paleontology and understanding the planet, but also the possibility that this has for, weaponization and something that is, extremely bad, so to speak, and is putting that to use for negative ends. But having said that as well, I want to point out then that You know, we're talking about weapons programs, and the first word in this seminar is design, and design and existential risk. But I think it's also worth pointing out exactly where undesign is the thing that puts us the most at risk. And it's been pointed out recently that if we were to reply to or respond to climate change with geoengineering programs, which is to say to design a new atmosphere, or to design continent-scale programs that would reverse climate change, spreading aerosols into the atmosphere to block sunlight and that sort of thing. If we could approach that with design, what would be what is the most beneficial example of terrestrial engineering? But what I think is important and what has been pointed out is that actually we are already in the midst of the most extensive terrestrial engineering program in human history, which is to say everyday life. And the most undesigned aspect of what we do, which is driving cars and running factories and turning on lights in households and running multiple computers to have simulcasts with speakers in New York City and Los Angeles, is all an electrical drain, and all of which has environmental consequences and creates what we now refer to as climate change in the sort of Cliff's Notes guide to that. But so in other words, we're already in the midst of a massive undesign experiment, and we're experiencing the effects of undesign at every scale. And what puts us arguably at the largest extent of existential risk right now is precisely the lack of, or finding ourselves in the midst of an experiment that no one is the head of, that no one designed and no one planned for, and now we think maybe we can design our way out of it. But arguably, the largest effects come precisely when something is undesigned, and when there is no one in charge. So I think that's another issue that I think deserves further exploration here. And then I guess just a sort of gesture towards some maybe themes that we can pick up in the conversation ensuing. I think that we talk about the idea of deep time and the idea of discovering that the Earth is much older than human history allows for us to comprehend. And the individual human mind, so to speak, can comprehend, but also to gesture towards deep future, as I might call it, and extreme futurity in the sense of understanding where things might be in 100 million years, in 1 billion years, in 3 or 4 billion years. I think it's sobering to realize and to remember that the Earth, at least according to geological and physical understanding now, is approximately 4.5 billion years old. But the estimated time between today, the present, well, as we speak right now, and the absorption of the Earth by the Sun when it goes red giant, is another 7 billion years. And so we're not even halfway there as far as the age of the Earth itself. Untold amounts of terrestrial change have occurred, let alone since humans arrived on the planet, but even since the industrial age began about 150 years ago. And I find it really both stimulating and also awe-inspiring to think about where things might be, let alone in another 150 years, but again, in another 4.5 billion years when the Earth is only 2 times as old as it used to be, and it will still have another 2.5 billion years to go. So extreme futurity as a kind of cognitive risk, so to speak, I think is something that would be worth picking up in the conversation as well. And all of these, I think, fall under the idea of exposing oneself not only to the inhuman, but to ideas that would otherwise appear to be incomprehensible, and to timescales that are radically exceed one individual human, but even the sort of human project writ large, and the very idea of human civilization. And I have a whole bunch of other quotes that I'd love to read about ecosystem collapse and radical future implications of where we are today. But I think in the interest of time, I'll maybe save those for the conversation itself. And I think I'll just leave it there.
Right. I'll set you up there as well. In the table.
Yeah.
Thank you. 2 minutes.
Definitely.
My data is received.
They were moving the computer, so probably the cable got disconnected. What are the other chats that are open?
I would say, check your television.
Yeah. They won't be able to. I think they know the answers.
Says they're offline.
Yeah. We're reestablishing a connection with New York. The Human Project writ large. That was a very nice way of putting it, Geoff.
There's some great quotes that I wrote down that I didn't know what to do. This book is really amazing, actually, Tara. But he's running out just like the sheer amount of time that it will take to recover from what we now call human civilization. As far as the Earth goes, but honestly, we might have enough dominated by past tending ecology.
Mm.
Right, they're not even why are they offline? He called her or something, or would that be disorienting?
I'm not sure about that. If anyone's watching, thanks for your patience. We're trying to reestablish a connection to New York.
Sorry about that.
Everything worked beautifully, and then we lost our connection. So I imagine we'll be back up in just a moment. There you go.
There we go. Okay. I like Bruce's talk, this one.
Yeah, that's right.
Hey, there, can you hear us?
Yeah.
All right.
Is this working? Can you hear me
there?
Can you hear me?
Yes, okay, we're out. Hey. Catastrophe still held at bay.
Yeah.
I guess to start the conversation, I would like to go back to the geoengineering, planet engineering thing to start. Maybe we can move into the historical time and future time. Remembering several things that, that's actually. We had a kind of a very brief conversation about John Ruskin and his looking at clouds,
storm
cloud of the 19th century, and how he is somehow proposing that the weather was different. It felt different. Something was going on. And I thought find that it was somehow interesting that there's always this relationship between the idea of perceived risk and real risk, and the way in which we think that we can actually attack it or deal with it, and this kind of hope right now with the atomic bomb. I think it was the first time where if one, for instance, listens to Robert Oppenheimer's discourse in 1946, he's very clear that there is no interesting thing to pursue in energy, in atomic energy. It's not a scientific interest, kind of a research on a scientific level that is interesting, and therefore he can speak as an expert to explain what exactly consists in what exactly consists atomic energy. But whenever he has to talk in front of any agency, what he'll need to talk is not as a scientist.
Right.
Because the problem is not scientific at all, he was the first to say. The problem is about of globalization, of unification of the world. It's a political and a social problem. Somehow, I think it was the first time where we realized that suddenly there was a weapon that if one engaged in warfare with that weapon, there was no play at all. It could not be used preventative at all.
Right.
Only it could be used by not being used. So there was some kind of interesting idea suddenly that was not even acupunctural. There was absolutely nothing one could do with that except the idea of somehow creating this distributed fear and this sharing of risk. And that's how the atomic bomb could be used. But of course, Oppenheimer saw that as a kind of very difficult situation, and therefore immediately what he saw important in developing that technology was a political technology. And along the way, I mean, there are several other issues that, and the geoengineering, this happens as well, where suddenly we feel at a particular moment that we seem to be asserting that it's special, where everything is so in such a bad situation right now that we can either do band-aids or these quadruple bypasses. So we can either do relief efforts and do little patches, or what we can do is to actually play with the emergent system in such a manner that we actually play unpredictability on the future, and somehow assuming that that's the only scale at which we can continue to work. So the geoengineering is departing from the idea that there is necessarily a finitude that we have to play with, but it's a system which is global, and so the measure is global. What planet engineering, it's a really different story. It's literally a travel into some kind of new environment and the reproduction characteristics. So I wonder, I mean, one of the first questions that I would ask is, are we in such a special moment where definitely there's some kind of threshold that we passed in terms of how our visualization of what risk is that different from previous times, or we're just in somehow part of a line that has been always having these kind of cycles?
Well, everybody wants to validate their own mind.
Mm-hmm.
It's very difficult to go out and tell people, well, you know, this is actually a rather boring and insignificant period of history. Where we're not really doing much of anything. Now, you know, not everybody gets an Oppenheimer moment where they get to go around quoting Sanskrit in the desert after just having blown something sky high. But, you know, like a lot of other people involved in the nuclear project, Oppenheimer himself never really recovered after that. He was a pretty good administrator when it came to building the bomb, but when it came to communicating what it meant to his political and military sponsors, he was really pretty disastrous. So he just kind of immense. So I have to be quite the Oppenheimer fan, but he certainly did not stop people thinking about atomic weapons, and I could fill this room with post-apocalyptic books and movies all set after nuclear war. And most of them are what the science fiction writer and critic Brian Aldiss referred to as cozy catastrophes. And it's a science fictional narrative which is post-apocalyptic, in which almost everybody's dead and all the cities are in ruin. But if you study the subtext, you find that the hero is actually having a pretty good time. Well, I mean, he gets like free apartments, and you know, he gets steal cars, and it was usually like a really hot, you know, punk chick in leather rags with a sawed-off shotgun. He's like really kind of scary in reel one, but he's like a dependable girlfriend by the end of the reel, and then it sort of ends up with a kind of, we're going up to build the new Thunderdome or whatever. And, you know, every Ballard novel is a disaster novel. They're all vehicles of psychic fulfillment.
Yeah.
And they're all about people's Thanatos resentment for, you know, conventional society and the considerable appeal that we have within our being to think that it would be just be great if most people were dead. Except me, so I can have all their stuff. And, you know, and this is like a genre that's gone on a long time. Now, you know, popular entertainment aside, and you could look at the career of a guy like Herman Kahn, who was a futurist in the 1960s, known as Dr. Doom, who did a lot of thinking about the actual use of nuclear weapons. And he was a thinker I respect very much. I really think the 1960s were a kind of golden age of futurism, where you know, contemporary futurism is actually quite backward and primitive compared to historical 1960s futurism, which was much more open-minded and willing to confront the implications of what was going on. And Kahn was the guy who invented terms like throw weight, kill ratio, these kinds of, you know, Pentagon instrumentalist terms for, you know, how you go and, like, bargain away your nuclear weapons. It's like, okay, like, seriously, you've got, like, a bunch of giant 50-megaton crude Russian bombs. We have, like, these sophisticated American multiple entry vehicles. And so how do we exactly figure out which one is worth which? I mean, how many of you guys can we in fact roast? You know, and because you have to, right? I mean, at least in theory. And people who listened to Kahn at the time, although I think he was a better communicator than Oppenheimer, were, you know, they were really weirded out by the guy. I mean, they hated his rationalism, and they really resented, really the fact that he wanted to tarnish people's, the appeal of nuclear destruction, its transcendent glamour. That he would talk about it as if, you know, nuclear weapons were so many refrigerators. And then he spoiled people's awesome mystical impulse and their sort of quasi-worship of the mushroom cloud by just sort of going at it in, you know, boring engineering detail. So you're kind of in a situation that's, you know, neither win nor lose. I mean, either you can sort of wrap yourself in Oppenheimer's physicalist mysticism, in which case the Congress just brushes you aside as an egghead creep. Or you can, you know, go into this sort of totally instrumentalized Herman Kahn version of, like, what is it that we're actually doing, which people find humiliating and ugly and in some sense profoundly anti-human. So you don't really get that way either way. Now, in terms of geoengineering, I happen to be quite the devotee of this subject. I could, like, list you geoengineering schemes to avert climate change. There are dozens of them. I mean, some more Brobdingnagian and Lilliput-like than some could conceivably work and might redress some of the difficulties we have from the fact that we've polluted the planet with basically entropic exhaust. We don't have an unmanaged experiment problem. We have an entropy problem. We've just plain covered the sky with dirt. So the problem with this is, as I see it, is two. First, we're very early on in the genuine climate crisis. It's a problem which is 200 years old, and it's going to be a problem that your grandchildren talk about with lively interest. So we're thinking we can do anything about this now, like people in 1911 trying to avert nuclear war. It's not that it's not going to happen, and not that it's not really dangerous. It's just we don't understand what we're doing, and our ability to undertake any kind of effective intervention is quite low. I mean, the easiest thing to do would be just nail all the coal mines shut. And we can't get enough political will to do that in basically any era. So the idea that we could, like, somehow then build giant cloud machines or, you know, solar radiation schemes is completely fantastical. And the second thing that's really problematic is that by far the cheapest and most effective geoengineering intervention is genocide. Just kill half of everybody, and you immediately cut emissions in half. And it's really cheap to do, and we're really good at it. And if there's real trouble in the sense of, like, you know, New York's underwater, or, you know, a Category 5 hurricane is taking out Washington, D.C., the likelihood of somebody vengeful, panicky, just plain losing it, and triggering a genocidal intervention, it makes every kind of common sense. And the only thing that would stop you from doing a thing like that is like, gosh, it's really morally objectionable. As opposed to like the sky turning brown and all your cities on fire, that's not really a major issue. And track record suggests people would do it. We've done it before. It might be atomic, it might be biological, it might be an entire set of things to do it. But it's the one thing we don't talk about because, you know, it's 1911 now and we're kind of preserving a veneer of civilization. We're not really in a massive, horrible crisis. So people would just do that. And it's human nature. It's got every kind of ethical, legal, social, and economic backing behind. Yeah, they'd kill each other. They'd kill something. Somebody would be bad. And somebody would be demonized. And, you know, and then there are various ways that it would go about, but genocide is geoengineering scheme number one. It's flat.
If
someone would design it, they would design that program.
I don't know if, again, let us know if there are volume issues on this end, but I might interject really quickly and say that I think that as far as the genocide idea goes, I think that the unfortunate reality of that actually is that if you were, say, to eliminate half of the human race, there's a pretty good chance actually that you would not affect the people who are the major polluters. And I think that in reality, the people that are most affected by climate change now and are most likely to be negatively affected by it are the people who have the least input in whether or not we can do something on a political or industrial level to actually change things. And so it's the population of sprawling third world megacities, I think, that are going to have the most disproportionate effect of climate change. And I think that, you know, in reality, we actually probably could see climate change reducing the human population by 50% in X amount of time, 200 years. But it'll be the very people that are knocked off first will be the people who, you know, did effectively nothing to cause the crisis in the first place. So anyway, it just might be the kind of situation where, you know, it's actually 10% of, I don't want to argue percentages of genocide right now, but I think that, you know, it would be a 10% of X amount of people, I think, would have a bigger effect than 50% of everyone. But anyway, again, I don't want to argue genocide at the moment.
Well, I do want to argue genocide.
Yeah, okay.
I would argue that, you know, genocide is not an act of justice, and if you actually decapitate a government and kill the powerful people in the government, that's not genocide, that's a liquidation of a ruling class, whereas actual acts of genocide, yeah, always fall on the weakest and the easiest to kill. I mean, it's like saying Hiroshima and Nagasaki didn't start World War II, and they didn't. I mean, Hiroshima and Nagasaki were actually headed outlying provincial towns, like blowing up Bayonne, New Jersey, and, you know, Fort Lauderdale, Florida, but that was enough to make the gesture. The idea that we're going to, like, somehow commit genocide against polluters is kind of absurd, because we're all polluters anyway, as you were pointing out earlier. You know, we're all using beautifully designed energy-sucking objects that are going up a smokestack somewhere. So, you know, I mean, yeah, I mean, I would be very happy to see the entire board of directors of ExxonMobil in Guantanamo, but that wouldn't really, well, it would help a lot, actually, but it would not redress the kind of genuine existential risk that I think would cause a massive lashing out. It's like saying that, well, you know, the Jews actually caused all the trouble in Germany, and that's why they were subjected to genocide, or the people in Uganda were really bad troublemakers, and that's why they were subjected to genocide, or the Muslims in Srebrenica were like the core of the difficulty, and that's just not how it works.
I mean, to me, this seems to tie back in a certain way to the question of the cozy catastrophe that Bruce was talking about, and how much of a future you can predict or you can project, not just for the one survivor like Charlton Heston in what was it? Help me out here. Which
Omega Man?
Yeah, yeah. But yeah, exactly. Yeah, which is exactly the scenario that you were describing, right? But how you can stop wedding yourself to the survival of one individual or even a small group of individuals, and broaden the question to ask what's worth preserving at all. So, is it that we want to preserve a very small percentage of the human race, or do we identify a kind of a meta class of information which is worth preserving, and then do our utmost to preserve that meta class against not only biological catastrophes on a geological scale, which could either be triggered by humans or which could be triggered by exogenous factors like gamma ray bursts or asteroids, but you actually try to identify the information structure that's the richest that we can interact with. And this goes in a way back to what Geoff was talking about in terms of encountering the alien, and preserve that information structure. So in a way, this is a kind of a triage strategy. This is kind of like the quadruple bypass that Carla was talking about. And it's not actually saving the human race. It's identifying that there's another system that's worth saving. The human race might be tangentially connected to it, like an extended phenotype, if you will. And we devote all of our energy towards saving that information structure. I mean, it's connected back to the idea of saving the human population, but it also changes the scale, the time frame. Geoff was talking about the need to think about extreme futurity. And I was really interested in that idea because, you know, it goes back to the kind of scenarios that you get from Arthur C. Clarke in Rendezvous with Rama or in 2001. You know, it's really presuming that there might be an intelligence which is interested in cultivating rich information structures on a galactic scale. And it would take action to conserve and preserve and extend those rich information structures on a galactic scale. So part of this is the ethical question and whether we actually do everything in our power to preserve every human being that's alive today. And part of this is a different form of ethics. It's a non-anthropocentric ethics, which would say, can we actually position ourselves in the deep time that that we're considering in this conversation? I know, for example, Elizabeth Ellsworth and Jamie Cruz are very interested in their work with Smudge Studio. Can we actually imagine what it's like to connect to that deep time or reprogram ourselves?
Just really quickly, I think that one of the things that reminds me of was there was a seemingly tongue-in-cheek but relatively serious proposal from Jerome Lanier to program the information of basically the human encyclopedia into the genes of cockroaches so that they would sort of breed and last forever. They'd survive all nuclear war and climate change.
Jerome Lanier was, using cockroaches as
archive. Yeah. Which, I think, adds a kind of a humorous aspect of this. But I think, and in some ways, I wonder if that doesn't over-prioritize the... But there's a kind of a archive fever, I guess is how Derrida would phrase it, but there's a kind of a obsession with preservation and archiving and registration and communication on that level that I think maybe is... this is just an open question, but I wonder actually if that sort of extremely long-term preservation of the human project is really the thing to shoot for, or to simply experience it in a certain degree of intensity in the present is not a... I don't know necessarily if that dichotomy holds, but I wonder if indefinite preservation is actually the way to go. Otherwise, you know, it's the infinite hard drive or the artificially intelligent self-preserving archive. You get into a sort of a delirious archival fever.
The Long Now Foundation is very big on that, and they've done a lot of thinking about. They're trying to build a 10,000-year clock and so forth. But there are various lines of theory about it. It's like, okay, should we just abandon stuff and kind of bury it in a dry cave, like the Dead Sea Scrolls, or should we try to build some kind of cult that sort of shows up and protects this thing? They basically decided to kind of compromise and actually build the thing in a cave out in Utah where nobody has any particular reason to go, but they somehow imagine a cult would go out and mine this sucker up for the next 10,000 years. Maybe, you know, I mean, why not? And, you know, maybe the cockroaches will go wind it up. I'm very keen on archive fever. I told them they ought to just make backups of civilization and bury them in jars. And I think that many, if you look at the things we've learned from the past, there are some things that our ancestors left for us that they really wanted us to see. But commonly, the things we really derive some benefit from are things they abandon. Just trash. Rubbish heaps. Get tremendous amounts of data out of rubbish heaps. Mm-hmm. And man, we're leaving rubbish heaps like nobody's business. And if our rubbish are our archives, and I think that they probably are, we've just got unheard of riches of trash.
Mm. Actually, I mean, the Manaugh Foundation conference you gave there in 2004 was about the singularity, which would be basically this event horizon.
Right.
Coming from, for those who don't know yet, which I imagine you're in the audience, but which would be this moment after which you literally could not predict any future. And this moment would arrive from an incredible speed and acceleration of technological advancement of some kind.
It's kind of rapture for the nerds, as they call it. a singularity is a black hole, so that's a familiar idea in science fiction. It's within science fiction, it's not really as popular as it was in the 90s, and we really kind of considered it hit, but there are subcultures of practice now that are still into the singularity. And people like the idea. I mean, I don't know. I mean, of such crooked timber as mankind is, nothing straight can ever be built. And we think that we'd be really keen to preserve our civilization and protect every human being and stuff, but we don't even protect ourselves or our children very effectively. I mean, you know, there are a lot of things you could do to extend your own lifespan. Number one is, like, don't smoke. You know, and number two is try not to get too fat. And, you know, when you look at the American population, they've made a dent in the smoking instead of relentless social engineering, but they haven't really gotten rid of it. And, you know, the obesity thing is just a fantastic epidemic. I mean, it's like a third of the population in a lot of American states. You know, they get up in the morning and look in the mirror, and I'm like, it looks good on me. So what are they supposed to be doing? I mean, you know, they're just kind of walking around as diabetic and heart attack time bombs, but not directly confronting that situation and not really in a position to confront it, and in fact gratify your psychic level that they are that way. And, you know, my suspicion is that's at every level. I mean, that's sort of in every... I mean, there are schools that don't want to be schooled, sort of court their own destruction. There are political parties that make insane and impossible demands. There are governments that, you know, confront their own destruction. There are, you know, children who jump off tall buildings. And this is just part of our nature. And we're not going to be able to sort of engineer that away. I mean, we love catastrophe, and we in some sense love our own mortality. Even if we are transhuman guys who somehow imagine we'll live for centuries. I mean, every guy I've seen who's a life extension enthusiast, you scratch the layer there and there's some kind of thanatopic trauma. Sure. There's something in this guy's personal background, a brush with death, the death of a loved one, that, you know, has made it personal and really induced a psychic kink.
So, go ahead.
No, you should go ahead. Oh, sorry.
But just look at the history of the arms race, you know, the nuclear arms race. I mean, these are supposedly rational superpowers. Why did they have to build gigantic ultra pyramids of world-destroying weapons? Wouldn't it be enough to destroy the world once? Or even just to wipe out the power structure on the other side? I mean, just kill the government. That's all you really have to kill, right? I mean, in order to, like, have a mutual assured deterrence, just your government blew us up and you all died for it, that would be enough. But that's not, in fact, what people did. On the contrary, they just, like, on us up. And they just wanted more and more and more and more and more sophisticated weapons in order to maintain the psychic charge of utter disaster. And that's how we really confront this stuff. We wrap it in psychic candy in order to give it its Jonestown Kool-Aid taste. And that's not what, I mean, there is another way to think about it. We haven't gotten there yet, but I think there's a sensibility that could, like, confront that. And it's probably, you know, as Geoff was saying about the sensibility that was spurred by finding giant monster bones in Europe. Yeah, that was super disturbing. I mean, there's still people wandering around, a lot of them running for office, who think that, you know, those monster bones were in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. I mean, they just can't get their heads around it. They're like, 4 billion years old, they lasted for 200 billion years. You know, they just, that's not in their narrative. They can't go there. And, you know, it is a kind of, I mean, it's something creationists can't handle, and a lot of people can't handle. So, but there are, you know, it turned out there was a sensibility that sort of was able to sort of, like, I kind of enjoy the idea that the Earth is 400 billion years old and that, you know, we evolved rather than being created. It's not too much for people to get their heads around. And, you know, not even rationally, but sort of culturally. And there are structures of meaning and feeling. People can deal with that. And I think there's a structure of meaning and feeling with which we can confront and deal with existential risk. It's just that we have bad habits of either chrome plating it or using it as a vehicle of psychic fulfillment or, you know, massaging our own egos with it or somehow imagining ourselves to be knights of valor or protecting something from it. And that's not what actually happens under those circumstances.
Well, we can come up with models that allow us to describe for example, the statistic likelihood that the great filter exists. The great filter being a probabilistic likelihood that any complex information structure gets wiped out given enough tens of millions or hundreds of millions of years. And that's a model, that's a scientific model or hypothesis which allows us to understand the likelihood that we might, not only we might survive, but that any complex organizational system and intelligence like us might survive. That's different than the model of the 48 hours post-catastrophe that we were talking about before. I thought that was a very interesting example, because if you assume that hardwired into human beings, when they go through that kind of radical context disarrangement, they're just going to have 2 days worth of total mindlessness or disruption, and then they'll start to reconstruct. If you can take advantage of that, which is obviously what media systems and advertisements and governments do, you can keep a population in check. This is where the kind of political dimension of the misuse of existential risk comes up that Bruce was talking about before. I think it's the state of emergency that Walter Benjamin and that Agamben have treated and many others have treated quite directly. If you can keep a population in the imaginative space that they think a state of emergency has taken place, then you can do a lot of different things with that population. If you can identify the mechanisms by which that narrative thread, that suspension of disbelief, is carried out, and then disrupt that suspension of disbelief, it's a form of reengineering, whether it's mental, partially mental and partially firmware, or purely sociological. I think you're still reengineering the population to become aware of themselves in a larger context. And that might be an avenue for putting people into the context where they can perceive these kinds of extreme futurities that Geoff was talking about. You know, it's an ethical issue on two timescales. One is the timescale of our own survival in the next 5 years, in the next 15, in the next 50 years. But then it's a kind of a deeper ethical question in terms of whether populations ever will be able to sustain that degree of self-perception and that degree of awareness. Historically, I think it's been a kind of a fluctuating peaks and valleys situation where you'll have a cluster of individuals who will be able to recognize their position in a kind of trans-historical, macro-historical field condition, and then they will die off, and their population, their children will slowly, or the field around them will slowly evaporate, and that body of knowledge will be lost. Presumably, if that's the dominant model, we could do something to extend that tail and preserve those kinds of conceptual structures or models. But if we look at the great filter example again, then we're looking at a much bigger time scale than most humans can even conceive. We're not talking about 5 generations or even 100 generations. We're talking about tens of millions or billions of years. And so I guess this is where the design question comes in. I think it's funny. The cockroaches should be winding the 10,000-year clock because it seems to me that there's such a kind of cognitive gap there in the idea that the 10,000-year clock is actually going to do anything and mean anything to any fairly intelligent organism. And so it's a kind of a poetic move. It's kind of like, you know, the old t-shirts that I used to remember seeing in high schools in the 80s where you have the mouse giving the finger to the bird of prey that's coming down on it, you know. It's like, okay, yeah, it's the kind of noble resistance to existential risk that Bruce was talking about before. There's something heroic in it, you know.
Well, there's something flattering. You know, I mean, unflattering to our egos, and think that like cockroaches have more future than we do, but they're certainly much older than us, and you know, statistically, they're probably gonna do just fine. I mean, the difficulty with this set of 2 days of bewilderment is that people don't really do very much during the bewilderment.
Mm.
And if you continue to inflict shock and awe on people, like, say, during the collapse of Nazi Germany, you don't really find people put into a more creative and imaginative headspace where they can sort of, like, confront larger issues of absolute possibility.
Mm.
Basically, they become mute. And even people who were diarists and, you know, maintained diaries during most of the war, there's just a gap in publication in the last days of Nazi Germany. I mean, there are very few memoirs from the Dresden bombing or very few things written about, you know, the Red Army coming in and sort of burning and raping everything they could get. People just stop paying attention. I mean, they really panic. And they don't. I mean, in states of panic, they fall back on, you know, a Giorgio Agamben-style bear lot.
They're
not really more visionary. So, you know, if you want to encourage visionary thinking about absolute kinds of futures, you just need to, like, put together things like, the Princeton Institute for Advanced Study, where you just basically pay extremely intelligent people to sit around blue skying about stuff like SETI.
Mm.
And people don't do that because it's very Laputan. You know, it doesn't really convey, people don't make money for it, and it seems like they're spinning their wheels. I mean, I really enjoy reading sort of great filter SETI metaphysics, because there's just a kind of cool sci-fi style kind of, I don't know, Jodoku puzzle thing going on in there. It's just like, it's sort of like an absolute form of scientific speculation. But a lot of people find that irritating, you know, especially funding bodies. You know, SETI is a thing that's like really easy to crowdsource, but extremely difficult to get Congress to vote money for.
Mm.
So, you know, you need, provoking panic instead of mind-blowing people doesn't really help you with that. You don't, if that's the really kind of discourse and thinking you want to do, you need something gentler and kinder and probably more popular. I mean, something that's parascientific or philosophical, with different funding sources and a different kind of archive fever and a different setup for that, and I don't think we'd have that, but we could. I mean, I see hints of like a speculative culture emerging, that there are people in programming and architecture and fiction and design who really are interested in just expanding the limits of the thinkable, but they're not tough guys. I mean, they're not 5'11 tactical dudes who are like going to really thrive under Mad Max circumstances. There are gentle souls like Geoff here, you know, who would be perfectly fine with just, you know, a corrugated tin roof and three square broadband, and, you know, he could do, like, great cultural work, you know. And they don't really need any more money or funding than Nietzsche. But it would be very handy to just have somebody do it.
Well, I think...
It's a modest scholastic one.
I think one of the things that comes out of this that I think is kind of cycling in the back of my head is just a question of strategy and sort of what one can do to sort of what you're talking about here, Bruce, where you know, a different level of cultural production or a different register for speculation that I think reaches more people or has more of an effect. I'm even tempted to say that you know, when you were describing future U.S. presidential candidates who don't believe in evolution or the age of the planet, I'm tempted to say that the way to influence them is not to write an article for New Scientist. It's to start writing Christian science fiction. It's to start writing biblical scholarship. You know, it's to engage on a different rhetorical level with people that to engage them on the things that they're already talking about. Which in some ways I think is what's so interesting about the success of that Left Behind science fiction epic. And that suddenly you've got people that would not normally be thinking about deep time, futurity, science fiction, etc. You know, this thing becomes a radically popular series of books that you know, you get on the bus and suddenly somebody's thinking about things that you wouldn't normally perhaps normally expect them to think about. But just going back a little bit to this idea of archiving and future traces and that sort of thing, I mean, I'm tempted to say again that any real attempt to, I don't know, do this deliberately, to take culture and bury it, to create a kind of pharaonic tomb for all time, I think is misguided and doesn't even understand the sort of geological nature of planetary transformation and that sort of thing. And I think instead that we're going to find that, you know, the traces that indicate that there ever was a human civilization are going to be found in things like a very, very thin layer of radioactive dust from World War II or from the next nuclear war, for that matter. And there will be no cities because they'll be eroded down or they will be, you know, subducted into the sea. And it will be these incredibly minor forensic traces that indicate that something happened at all. And in fact, I'm reminded of some of the more exciting cosmological discoveries, which tend literally to be described as fossils. So you see fossils of the Big Bang discovered in the background radiation of space. You don't actually see the Big Bang. You see extremely unexpected minor traces of the Big Bang. And I think as well that, you know, when it comes to these things where, you know, you put a golden record onto a satellite and you send it into space in order to communicate with aliens, it's such an unbelievably minor sort of pinprick, as you might say, of a almost like an epistemological gesture to self-record and communicate with the other, that I think in fact it'll be something totally different. You know, it's the golden spike of nuclear fallout that will record that humans were ever here, or just some other unanticipated thing that will archive human beings. And I'm tempted to say then that, you know, we really just don't know how to build these sorts of things. And in fact, actually, just to as a kind of postscript to that, and since Elizabeth Ellsworth is in the room over there. One of the things that I think is also fascinating are these extremely long-term projects that are being undertaken by energy departments at in different countries around the world. Here it's the Department of Energy and the now failed project for Yucca Mountain, where they wanted to entomb nuclear waste for up to 1 million years. But there's actually a repository that's going online in Onkalo, Finland. Onkalo actually means hiding place, which I think is quite interesting and quite poetic. But there was a film that actually Elizabeth and I were in the audience to see at the Tribeca Film Festival that was about the construction of Onkalo and the entombment of nuclear waste for up to 1 million years. And one of the more telling moments was the engineers who were building this massive underground cavern. It's an artificial cavern being excavated with dynamite and tunneling machines where they will store nuclear waste effectively in perpetuity. One of the jokes amongst these geotechnical engineers is that when they get to the very bottom and they're about to start installing the copper canisters full of nuclear waste, they're going to dig down another 10 feet and uncover copper canisters from someone else who left them there 100 million years ago. And it's these kind of unexpected fossils, you know, traces that we might not see, and these like shock forensics of alien traces that I think are actually the most stimulating aspect of this kind of existential risk, exposure, deep time, etc.
Right.
Well, you know, I'm not a big devotee of that stuff, but I love the sort of Lovecraftian and Stapledonian romance of elder cultures, you know, that have obliterated. I would give us a little more credit than that. I think we've left spacecraft in orbit that are going to be up there for geological periods. And another of our successors, intelligent beings who went up there instead of just looking around in Clark orbits and so forth, they're going to find a lot of our hardware. And I also think a lot of our junk is actually going to be fossilized. I mean, it will just literally become fossilized, and we'll, you know, you'll be digging out fossil radios in another 200 million years. And, you know, in theory, at least, we could find spacecraft and fossilized technology on the planet. I mean, when we're digging up all these dinosaurs, we might find a brief intelligent dinosaur flourishing period where we realize we're not the only intelligent inhabitants of the planet, or even the only ones who were ever born here who were smart. And that would be very upsetting.
Hmm.
I mean, more upsetting than dinosaurs' bones is the idea that maybe there were dinosaurs around who were smart like us. And as a final fill-up, I would point out that I Love Lucy broadcasts reach a new star system every year. That's how far this bubble of popular entertainment has gone. And with a large enough telescope, you can find that stuff out, you know. We blasted out unintentional messages into our part of the galaxy that could last for millennia, really, if you have sensitive enough equipment to find it. So we're noisy, and we've left a big mess.
This goes back to the question of what's worth saving, you know, and I think that from one point of view, there's a kind of an embarrassment that I Love Lucy is a front runner for bringing information about humans to potential other intelligent life forms.
Well, they might be big fans.
They well may be. They well may be. I mean, the thing is, if you look at it from a metacritical perspective, they'll be looking with completely.
They might show up and demand a conga.
And why wouldn't that be good, right? I mean, it's just as good as us knowing anything about Giorgio Agamben's thinking and Walter Benjamin and the whole.
Other alien cultures on our planet love I Love Lucy.
Indeed.
Like big Ecuador, Madagascar, you know, everywhere.
So shouldn't we just save everything we possibly can? I mean, this goes back to the singularity issue that Carla was bringing up. I know that one way of looking at the singularity is to say that it's a potential black hole that when we hit it, we will go through a technological threshold beyond which human acceleration will be so extreme, we literally won't know from moment to moment what could possibly happen. But let's say that it's a little bit more of a gentle arrival. Let's say, you know, that people like Ben Goertzel and Eliza Yudkowsky are successful in what they're working on, and we get an artificial general intelligence, which is, I don't know, not friendly to humans, but neutral, and which is willing to go along for the ride with us and saying, you know, let's save everything. Let's save as much as we possibly can. And to collaborate with us on engineering a possible future. I know I sound like I've drunk the Kool-Aid here, but, you know, bear with me. That's one possible future within the next century, right? I mean, it's not guaranteed, but one possible future is we do hit that kind of technological threshold. And we make it through the threshold to a place where we have a dialogue with a radically non-human entity that is at least neutral, if not benevolent, towards human beings. So what kind of changes does that bring to the discussion when we start talking about extreme futurity? Can we look at a 5,000-year horizon, a 1,000,000-year horizon, and actually anticipate that some intelligences that are here right now will make it through those horizons?
Well, I don't like to outguess our million-year successors. But, you know, I do talk to archivists, and I think their design principles will work pretty well here.
Sure.
Trying to save everything means saving nothing. That's a non-starter. I mean, you can't save everything. We don't really want to. And the one thing that really seems to work is lots of copies keep stuff safe. The idea that you build sort of a super Alexandria that holds on everything just invites vandalism.
Yeah.
People can't stand the idea of it being there.
So, you know, should we be heading for an actual singularity where, you know, artificial intelligence is going to start coming in and dictating whatever the hell we're going to do? If we were really concerned about saving our legacy, we would make lots of copies of stuff, and we would hide it in places hidden even from ourselves. We would just bury it for a million-year thing and just remove any trace of its existence so that it would never even be suspected by our successors. The idea of our doing that, even though it's an excellent design strategy, where's the payoff? Where's the ego boost? Where's the economic substrate for that? It's very rational. It's the sort of thing we would never actually do. And it's just, it's too far-sighted and too, you know, it's basically too noble for us to get away with because it doesn't, you know. The guys who are archiving stuff want to be known as great archivists. They don't want to be known as great concealers of knowledge. As far as we know, we don't have any class of people whose main interest is, you know, a demographic audience a million years in the future. I mean, I'd be happy to contribute to that. You know, I've got 10 bucks right here, brother. You know, you want to, like, send a message to a million years AD, I'll, like, send them a few novels. But we don't really have any institution that could do anything anywhere near so sensible.
I mean, what about the negation of singularity, actually? I'm remembering from the same lecture you gave
right.
at Manaugh Foundation, and one of the groups you mentioned is exactly the group who's trying to prevent singularity from happening. So, in a way, if one does not understand the idea of positive and negative singularity, because
right.
it is the oblivion of memory that the singularity could bring, cannot be valued in those terms, and probably it could be positive or negative for exactly that reason. And so, what we can evaluate is the types of groups that gather around the idea of singularity, and those who are interested in the prospect, those who are interested in negating it, and the place where this somehow enters in conflict with the idea of freedom of the scientific experiment and development.
Hmm.
And I remember from the one of the groups that you were mentioning is exactly all these strategies that seem already in place, like commercialization of science, right, or bioethics, which seem to delay the capacity of research and development to actually work and actually arrive to interesting results. And at the time, I think you were playing with the idea, but that's actually something that plays into the unpredictability of that event as something that actually is in front of us.
No, a singularity is a world-ending notion, and people are always keen to end history, and it doesn't actually end. And you know, the idea just becomes corny, and, you know, the singularity is a corny idea. And it's you know, it was a prediction by a science fiction writer that was made in these early 90s. It was predicting, you know, artificial intelligence jumping up of the wall, you know, too cheap to meter by the 2010 at the earliest. I mean, we're nowhere near that happening. So I don't consider the singularity an existential risk. I mean, the singularity is a sci-fi conceit that has found some traction in certain niches of popular culture. But there's no there. I mean, it ain't going to happen. We don't need to protect ourselves from that. There are other risks to our well-being, like giant asteroids, that are very well documented, that we could do something worthwhile about if we wanted to budget it, that we don't actually do. Because, you know, it's like expensive and difficult and an easy thing to put off. So I would urge, you know, focusing some attention on things that really could mess with us. And, you know, and I don't have any problem with sci-fi ideas percolating into popular culture. I mean, it's not the only one we have. There are lots of them. Time machines. We don't have any. We're not going to have any. They're fun. They're fun to think about. You know, they're like the premises of movies. And, you know, it's like a cool fantasy to have. And we're richer for the idea of a time machine, even if it's not really a practical idea. And, you know, singularity is a thing in popular culture we're not going to be able to escape, you know, because it's just tied into Judeo-Christian thinking, and it's just, you know, it's a thing with another chromium layer of paint on it, and we're not going to even be able to get away from that any more than we can get from the, you know, the cultural heritage
of, you know, the apocalypse in the Bible or various other world-ending, history-ending schemes. So there's not a lot you can do about it. It's not something that ought to be brutally repressed, but it's something that is going to become corny. I mean, just like, wow.
So in that sense, we could focus design. In that sense, we can focus design energy on specific risks that are very obviously identifiable, like asteroid impacts, or global warming, or emergent diseases, or maybe even on the edge of things, a kind of gray goo nanotech scenario. So, I mean, if we talk about it that way, then we really are talking about existential risk within a 50 to 100 year time frame. And we don't take on any of the kind of millennia of millennia ambitions of preserving something that we think is important. Again, the beautiful ruins that you were talking about vis-a-vis Speer that Bruce brought up, I thought was, again, an interesting horizon. But it's so bounded by the idea of 3 millennia or 4 millennia worth of human ability to perceive time. But with that said, then perhaps the design and existential risk question is to de-romanticize the idea of existential risk, decouple it from any kind of political mechanism that allows governments to control people by using it as a motivator, and say, well, there are some very basic pragmatic questions that have to do with existential risk that are real, and that we actually know a lot about, that we can take on directly, head on, and attempt to do something with. I mean, I'm totally for that. I'm all for that. I admit that I'm very persuaded by the possibility that there could be a technological singularity, but I don't know exactly what it would really take to make that happen. I mean, I find myself thinking sometimes that, like the old idea that we're not going to contact the aliens because they already have arrived and they are us. We are the aliens, right? That, you know, some kind of meta pattern, DNA itself is a, in a Philip K. Dickian way, a vast active living intelligence system. Is a very beautiful idea to me, and I can't. To me, I guess that's my. That's where it's the romanticism is very seductive. I can't leave that idea behind because I find it so enchanting. But with that said, perhaps we do focus on very specific, obvious existential risks, and we use everything in our power to decouple them from the mind-numbing romanticism of them.
I think just to jump in about this question, though, of encountering the other and encountering an alien intelligence or an artificial intelligence that we create that comes back to haunt us in some sort of almost techno-poltergeist way, or encountering maybe the alien is our DNA. I'm almost tempted to say that there is an ongoing encounter with alien logics, and it's one of the reasons why I'm really interested in geology. And I feel like the Earth itself has a formational logic, and the mineral lattices that form in the sort of outer mantle, and these liquid continents beneath the surface of the Earth, etc. I think are actually extremely exciting and very, very alien environments and very alien constructions and so on. And so I'm almost tempted to say that one of the things I think is so exciting about, and in fact, even you can kind of trace this throughout the history of geology, where people have the famous example is that when 18th century travelers would take their horse and carriage through the Alps, they would actually pull the curtain down because it was too disturbing to look at the banded rock layers and the extreme metamorphic pressures that had formed the mountains. And it's almost as if, you know, we don't want to look. It's a kind of terrestrial horror show.
That's beautiful.
And I think that you still see these sorts of things where, also like Ed, there's a writer, Reza Negaristani, who's an Iranian philosopher of this sort of the alien Earth, so to speak, or what I like to call the post-terrestrial. But the idea that there is, in fact, an alien logic inside the very thing that we call terra firma. So I think that that's something that should be really explored and is exciting. Metallurgy, in some ways, then, is more alien than biology or more alien than physics. But I just want to go back and say I also think this kind of the emphasis on preservation so far and archiving in the conversation is rubbing me a little bit the wrong way, in the sense that I'm not necessarily interested in extremely long-term preservation projects, in the sense that I almost feel that we should not be seeking to be better archivists. We should be seeking to be better explorers. And I know that that's very cheesy and it's corny to use your term, Bruce. But I feel like maybe we should step out of the archive and put away the preservation tools and see what we can still yet explore, make, or discover. And I feel that in some way then, I understand that that's not a perfect dichotomy, but I just think it's more interesting to go in the opposite direction and see what is still out there on an experiential level. That we have yet to do, we have yet to find, or we have yet to see. And in some ways, then I'd rather see the energy of this kind of conversation, or at least of some secondary conversation occurring somewhere that really does look at those proactive aspects of creating things, as opposed to just sort of archiving what has already come to pass. But maybe that's just my own kind of allergy to. I think I'm in some ways kind of pro amnesia, in the sense that getting rid of things is actually frequently the most the best thing you can do in order to move into the future, and you know, shedding the load, so to speak. But at least it works for me on a personal level.
Yeah, well, entropy requires no maintenance, and things do decay when they're left alone, just the laws of physics. So to be pro-amnesia is kind of a good idea, because you're rooting for the winners in the second law, thermodynamics.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a distinction here. I mean, I think what we're seeing here is a schism between futurism and design. And they're not the same thing, because futurism is a method of vision and design is a method of action. So, you know, if you want to get futurists to blue sky about existential risks, that's not a hard thing to do. It's usually a pretty good idea to throw a few scientists into the mix of it, just to make up really cool, weird notions. That would not be a hard thing to do. I mean, you just endow some guys to, like, think about existential risks, and as long as they weren't designing anything, things would be fine. I mean, they could just write multi-volume books about horrible things that might happen to us. But if you actually want to do design interventions, you know, involving existential risk, there are some that you could do that would be pretty cheap and effective, like, you know, just coming up with an archival method that would last a million years. It'd be like an episode of Mythbusters, basically. Just like you go out and get Adam Savage and say, boys, you know, here's your usual thing. It's like, we need to, like, design some gizmo and we're going to, like, bury him for a million years. You know, and they're, like, ingenious characters of, like, special effects stuff, and they come up with some scheme, and they go bury it, you know, and sort of end the story, and, you know, the thing would be accepted, and, you know, that is a design intervention that some clever group of people could obviously do. I mean, it's not a budget-busting thing, and it wouldn't necessarily require, you know, re-engineering the basis of consumer capitalism. It's the sort of thing that, like, IDEO could do.
You
know, if somebody paid for it and, like, put it, you could start a Kickstarter thing. Whereas a giant subterranean explosion in a supervolcano, as Geoff was talking about, you know, like the interior of the earth boils and the Deccan flats come out and, you know, there's like cubic miles of basalt. Okay, we're toast. And we're done under those circumstances. And some of our civilization would survive, but whatever interventions we could do, I mean, it would be so overwhelming that just the things that we could do instead of bipeds on the surface of the planet just don't really get much traction. So it's, you know, it's an interesting thing to think about, and it's scientifically factual, and there have been supervolcanoes, and, you know, the human race was almost exterminated by one 80,000 years ago. We went through a genetic bottleneck because of the Toba supervolcano, and it almost killed us off as a species, and this is like a genetic fact. So, you know, obviously it's a genuine existential threat. It almost ended our existence 80,000 years ago. If it happened tomorrow, we'd be just as badly off. I mean, there'd probably be 80,000 of us left, and God only knows where we'd be. Well, someplace random. It wouldn't necessarily exterminate us, but it would just be a catastrophic thing that's sort of sitting around with our, you know, Muji pens and blueprints is not going to get us anywhere with that. So, you know, it's sort of useful to be aware of things like that, but there's not an area where we ought to devote a lot of design attention, because it's just not. I mean, we can't plug a supervolcano. You know, it's beyond the ability of our civilization to affect that natural phenomenon.
But
there really isn't there isn't a civil defense thing we can do to really help, you know. We don't have the capacity to escape it. The only way to escape it would be to leave the surface of the Earth. We don't really have the ability to move enough of us off there to do anything about that. So, you know, that's one of these things that's just a measure of our incapacity. And it would be more interesting to actually measure our capacity and, you know, do things that can be done. And that's what design is all about, right? It's about constraint and, you know, proper use of materials and, you know, the confronting the grain of the material and make some kind of intervention that actually
matters. I mean, I suppose there are two ways. There are two ways of looking at that. One would be with resignation to say, oh my gosh, well, you know, I guess we've identified some existential risks which are quite real, and there's a very, very small likelihood that they'll happen, and there's absolutely nothing we can do about it. But it goes back to one of the ideas that was floated a while back in the discussion, which is we none of us get out of here alive to, you know, again, borrow a title from some biography of Jim Morrison I remember seeing back in the 80s. And in that sense, we still continue living on a day-to-day basis and deriving pleasure and agency from the fact that we have a given amount of time. So I guess it reframes the question for me in terms of design around whether design should attempt to solve all of those kinds of problems, or if design in and of itself, just like Charlie Parker playing one riff in 30 seconds at one moment in his life, is a substantial enough achievement to say that that design was good. I'm approaching this a little bit from a Zen point of view, to say that any moment of quality, any moment which has a certain degree of intelligence invested in it, would then be an act of design which in some sense critically engages this idea of archiving or not archiving, you know, productive amnesia that we're talking about. I think that architects tend to gloss over these questions. Even the Speer kind of engagement with it is a little bit of a gloss, because there is an unwillingness for the architect to fully confront their own end. And so there's a presumption that they will never end, not all architects, but most architects. And if they do, there will be a legacy which will be around to receive the information that's encoded in the architecture, in the city, in the infrastructure. I think it would be very productive for individuals who design for multiple generations to become aware of the potential absolute meaninglessness, and I'm not saying this in a vacuous postmodern way, the absolute meaninglessness of any act of design at all. You know, I think that one of the interesting conversations I saw a few years ago was between Peter Eisenman and Mark Wigley. Mark, who is going to join the Existential Risk series in a few weeks. And the thing that I took away from their conversation was that they had very different ideas about what would constitute consciousness within a historical framework and what architecture's role could be, what design's role could be in building out consciousness within a historical framework for an individual or for a collective. And indeed, I thought my understanding of it was that Peter Eisenman's position was that information had to be embedded in systems so that it could be found. That was in some way the goal of the designer. Not that it would ever be legible. It would kind of be like Geoff's idea that a future civilization would identify a trace of nuclear fallout on the planet. They would have no idea who we were, any rich information, but they'd know that something interesting had happened there. And that Wigley's position was more that it wasn't so much about the information, even if it was undecipherable, being left for future intelligence. It was that the moment of the event had to be the place where intelligence recognized. And this is the Charlie Parker example that I'm bringing up in a way, that the moment of awareness that something was happening was the site where design could exercise its greatest capacity, and where the kind of full poignancy of the human condition could get realized. And I think those two, and again, I'm characterizing Mark and Peter, and they would probably disagree with my characterization of them, but I think that polarization in terms of the role of design, for me, is a really effective way of highlighting and underscoring what the kind of challenge is as we try to design something or anything, regardless of whether it's going to last for just a few seconds or last for 3,000 years and leave a beautiful ruin.
Well, something I think I enjoyed disagreeing with Peter Eisenman, even if he's filtered through Ed, but I think one of the things that something that really kind of blew my mind, and just when I first saw it when I was about 13, is this thing called Widmanstätten structure, and it's the extremely fine knit iron meteorite that has cooled over basically at 1 degree Fahrenheit over like per million years, forms an incredibly precise grid that looks almost like a Zaha Hadid painting from the early 80s. And it's kind of a suprematist geometry made out of iron filaments. And the thing is, when you saw through one of these iron meteorites and you polish it and you put it in a museum, it looks like an artifact. It looks artificial. It looks like a microchip or that sort of thing. And so it's the presence of structure, but you can't necessarily assume that an intelligence, unless there's a mineral intelligence or some other kind of material, Manuel de Landa-like intelligence inside iron itself. So in other words, my point is that it's random. It's quote unquote natural. It's something that would appear to give off the illusion of a system, but isn't necessarily one. There's not intelligence behind it. So anyway, I think that that's kind of interesting. But then also, I'm tempted to just point out another example. I think it was I don't remember who, but I think David Kahn refers to this person in his book Code Breakers, if that's the correct author.
Yeah.
But there was one. There was a government cryptographer, someone who studied cryptography in the Second World War. But it got to the point where he was so consumed with legibility and with finding the code, but behind the things that were presented to him, that he basically went insane. And it got to the point where even if you gave him a memo and you put a memo on his desk, or you gave him a piece of mail that had been sent to him from his sister, he would start decoding the way in which the letters were on the page, or dissecting the number of E's that had been used in the memo, et cetera, et cetera. But this turned into a kind of a paranoia for systems, and a paranoia of legibility, and the radical imposition of something into something that otherwise bore a totally different kind of meaning, or perhaps no meaning at all. I don't know, those kind of moments of paranoia and understanding a system as having meaning that it doesn't, I think is also part of this, human nature or whatever, you know, we've been talking about, you know, kids are going to jump off buildings, all the things that Bruce was talking about earlier. I think there's a natural kind of inclination to overread situations. And anyway, so I guess this is all an elaborate way of disagreeing with Peter's sense of a system. Because if you want to find a system in something, you're going to find it. All you have to do is define your parameters and just drink enough coffee, and you're going to find a system in everything.
Right. Well, I'm a science fiction writer rather than a designer, but hanging out with designers has affected the way I think science fictionally, and I think for the better. So, you know, let me just pose you a designer koan here. I mean, we're talking about the human race going extinct, and we're, like, upset about that. So we'd like a design intervention that helps us get past that existential risk so we can exist again as a species. Okay, I just thought of, like, a cool, cheap way to design this. Just take some stem cells, human stem cells, and you embed them in beads of amber, just pine tree sap. And then you use, you know, your kind of standard Jurassic Park scheme. And you make these things slightly radioactive, so that only a civilization is likely to find them. So you go make about 1 million of them, with, you know, a little bit of human DNA carefully preserved in every one of these little pine sap. Got amber guys, and then you just scatter them around the surface of the planet sort of at random. Okay, you know, they're pretty well bound to last as long as other amber things, right? And if we're followed by another civilization over a 50 million or 500 million year period, and they have an understanding of physics, they're going to, like, find these little capsules and clone us and restore us to the surface of the planet. So now that's a design intervention rather than a sci-fi idea. Because there's no reason you couldn't do that. I mean, it's perfectly practical. I mean, you could budget that for maybe $100,000. So, I mean, it's a sci-fi writer's idea, right? So, you know, it's not really a designer, but it's just like, who's going to pay for that? So I'll give you the extra thought. Suppose you find out that there's a cult group of gay people, and they decided to solve only gay stem cells into this thing. Because, you know, they think gays are genetically different from others, and they don't like being here, and they want to have, like, gay human beings in the future, and they start this particular design intervention. Because it's perfectly legal. And there's no reason you can't put human cells into pine tar and bury them. What do you think the public reaction would be to this design intervention against a human existential risk? What would happen? Or if you don't like gays, let's just say it's somebody else, Mormons. Mormons are big on this kind of, you know, archival continuity. What would happen?
Well, I can speculate.
I mean, I don't think you could do it as a federal project, but there's no reason why it couldn't happen. You know it could happen because, you know, it would be easy to design, right? I mean, probably crack could do it.
I could speculate on all kinds of outcomes.
Actual design intervention that would, like, give the human race over, like, a 250 million year period. It would actually project us into the future. Capsules, you know. I mean, it's no weirder than, you know, the sort of icicle, corksicle stuff that people have been putting corkses, you know, in liquid nitrogen, alcohol.
Yep. Alcohol, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's a corny idea. I mean, the cryogenic thing is like 60, 70 years old now. It scarcely gets anywhere. I mean, it's just like it's a design intervention which is achieving the same end. It's just a much longer time frame, right?
Well, I think if the population of people who archived their cells in amber was widely known, and it was a subpopulation that identified in a particular way, it was a subculture, I think you would see other subcultures doing things like archiving their own DNA.
We
or
must close the amber gap.
Exactly.
I'm inclined to agree with you. I think it would be a provocation that other people would be forced to answer. I actually thought the same thing about Long Now Foundation. I told them that, but if they succeeded in building a plausible 10,000-year clock, somebody would want to build an 11th episode. Mine goes to 11. You know, they would sort of have to.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it sounds comic, but I mean, the thing that's good about design thinking is that it removes you away from this kind of, you know, golden sci-fi hand-waving and confronts you with the actual possibilities of, you know, things that can be done within physical constraints that, I mean, you just tackle them head on. That helps a lot.
Yeah. It's occurring to me that we're probably close to the end of the session, and I was thinking maybe we could see if anyone in the audience, either there or in the audience online, has anything that they want to chime in on in relationship to what we've been talking about.
They're busily, you know, drawing blood samples. How hard did that be? Kickstarter, here I come.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll ask in the audience here if you don't find anything online as well. But I'll start by asking here. Yes.
Yeah, please.
Okay, so just a question. Can you hear?
No, we didn't hear that.
No.
Okay. Could you come here? Or maybe, is there a microphone?
Yes.
We're getting a microphone, so that you can hear the question.
My question is about the bringing it back to the 10,000-year clock alone now. It seems like a lot of archive projects are this kind of cozy apocalypse. Like, there'll be an apocalypse that someone will sit room with nice wood reading our memoirs, whatever. But the Danny Hillis's goal with the clock of the long now was to project his own thinking forward so that he had to worry about continuity for 10,000 years. And, you know, what about geological changes in the site of the clock? Or what about how the metals are distorted by time? What if the sky is covered over by volcanic ash for 100 years and the clock can't realign itself with that meaning? And so I was wondering about kind of projects that resist an archival approach in order to actually extend that long future within our active design concerns that way. And to get at Geoff's point about not amnesia, but something to cause us to think forward.
Yeah, I think that Long Now group leaves themselves open to criticism there because, of course, it's about, on some level, it's about, you know, here we are 10,000 years from now, us who thought about this, and that leaves them to be deflated by somebody who wants to have a longer now, or just makes two plots or whatever. But, you know, Danny really is a designer, and he's quite a good designer, and nobody else but he could have made that clock, and, you know, the amount of intellectual and creative labor that was invested in that is quite impressive. I mean, there's a little known chainsaw carving, laser carving device they've come up with to, like, dig this cock tube, and that thing's sort of ultra nifty, too. And I give them credit for like going for it. I mean, they've been at it for a long time and have not lost their enthusiasm. And considering that the guys involved in it are like a lot of counterculture celebrities, you know, Brian Eno, Danny Hillis, and various other kind of long now worthy Stuart Brand and so forth, it's been sort of great that they keep such a low key about it. That it's not sort of a giant statue of Stuart Brand, you know. It's actually something which is meant to be a contribution to the discourse, and it's also meant, I mean, even if it doesn't work, it's meant to disturb contemporary people and force them to confront the implications of longer term stuff. So I'm quite a fan. And it is a design intervention. It doesn't necessarily deal with existential risk, but it shows what a small group of dedicated, far-thinking people can do. And, whether it works or not, or even if it just sort of collapses after 5 years, I think it's a worthy thing to do in the way, like, most propaganda of the deep can have an outsized effect. And it was better than writing a sci-fi novel about a clock that lasts a long time, which is not hard to do, but, kind of weak compared to the stakes.
Mm. I mean, you have this famous quote that I very much appreciate, which is that as far as science fiction goes, it's better to be fully mistaken than dully accurate.
Well, science fiction writers are not scientists, so we don't figure out things to six nines of accuracy. That's not really our purpose.
Yeah. Any more questions?
The undertone of the discussion indicates something a lot of people have talked about, the destruction of capacity and so forth. Also, this, what attends to that question is, to that issue is the notion of preservation and archiving, which goes against the opposite. But my question to you is that most of the discussion is primarily predicated on the matter energy methods of understanding reality, so to speak, as opposed to information. It's coming from a computation and algorithm standpoint. One can say that one can store information. Would it be better to store information, or would it be better to generate information? Because we are still operating under the supposition that to archive is to store things, that store things in packages. But very quick, earlier on, we mentioned about the fact that the television program Lucy, I Love Lucy, is being broadcasted across the universe. But what if another agency is to detect that on the other side, they have to decode that information, copy it, and recapture it as a I Love Lucy, so to speak. So we are not talking about primarily in terms of the energetic equation, even though that's related to the entropy, the second law of thermodynamics, and how information contributes against disorder, but how one can extract order out of disorder. So in that sense, one can then look at the notion of existential risk as the destruction of information content itself. So how would you understand it in that framework?
You guys want to tackle that?
Sure. Well, I just want to say hi to Carl Chu because I recognize his voice. Geoff, do you want to jump in on that?
You go for it. No. Well,
my personal feeling about that is that information is a period notion, and there are a lot of periods in history when we didn't know what information was. And when we were trying to archive something, we were archiving books or writings or statues or something, and we didn't really think about information in sort of computational or algorithmic terms until the 1940s, and I'm not convinced that necessarily goes on much longer. We may end up doing things that we would call computation, but they might be surpassed by something else. So it's not like that's some kind of million-year version of reality that we can rely on entirely. That said, I don't think I Love Lucy is particularly difficult to decode. I think that were we to receive television signals from another planet, we would quickly realize that they have some kind of mathematical regularity, and we would be very interested, and we would really work on it.
And even though they were alien, if they had the regularity of television signals, which repeat at a 60 minute thing and have like an extra, I think we'd be able to figure that one out. I don't think it's a, I don't think that would be a tough nut to crack. So, and it wouldn't be because it was information necessarily. I mean, we just heard something coming from another planet that was clearly not of natural origin. We devote a lot of attention over quite a long period to sort of like figure that out. I don't know whether other people would like be that keen on our level. See, they might figure out that it's something on a screen and then not be able to recognize what the hell we're doing.
Yeah, I feel. I feel like as well a kind of a sub theme here though is the is this interpretability of the signal, and I think that you know, even if you look at everything from just pulsars to even whale song, I think that there's either something could be biological but uninterpretable in the sense of whale song, or it could be very regular and apparently intelligent, but again, natural or it's a material effect. So, you know, when pulsars were discovered and the idea that there was something that is so infinitely repeatable, almost like a techno rhythm in space, suddenly realize, oh, never mind, it's just a star rotating at great velocity. And I think that if you get a high enough complexity system with enough pulsars and enough gravitational lensing and that sort of thing, it might appear to be a kind of scattershot I Love Lucy sort of rhythm, but I think that you could easily get into kind of the problem of the code breaker, you know, this infinite paranoia of detecting a system or a signal where there is none. But I also am tempted to say that a lot, so much of this, I think, gets away from the fact that, you know, we're constantly discovering. One of my favorite Wikipedia entries of all time, actually, is it's an entire Wikipedia page for unexplained noises that were found underwater, and there are things that you can listen to audio samples of them. But apparently, I think it was the year 1997 in the South Pacific was a very active year for unexplained, extremely loud undersea noises. And nobody knows what they are today yet, unless that information is classified. But so when you find everything from, say, dolphins, who are effectively an intelligent life form, but don't, you know, speak in ways that we can understand, or whale song, or inexplicable machine sounds from the bottom of the sea, you know, I don't know. I'm tempted to say we don't need to go as far as the other side of the universe to be confronted with informational signals that have regularity and we don't understand them. Again, just to go back to mineralogy, where if you need something that is repetitive, is rhythmic, is predictable, and geometric, you know, you don't need to find signals from deep space or I Love Lucy. You can look at salt crystals, or you can look at the structure of metals in underground mines and that sort of thing. So anyway, we're constantly surrounded by things that could be intelligent and are repetitive and appear to be patterned. But I just think it's a mistake to have to feel that we need to look off planet, so to speak, to find the alien. I feel like the Earth, again, like the Earth is already post-terrestrial.
I think here, just to think about pulsars and geometric lenses being used to broadcast I Love Lucy.
It's another Kickstarter.
There you go, galactic Kickstarter. We have these mysterious symbols from the Milky Way. We had better broadcast them back with our gigantic pulsars. Fabulous. I would argue against that. I think if dolphins had television, we wouldn't mistake it for anything else. And on the contrary, we'd get super interested. Mm-hmm. And television is a broadcast thing. You know, it's just any sort of radio astronomer would know immediately that television was not some kind of lattice. It's just, it's too obviously engineered, especially when you started getting lots of other broadcasts on other channels, and they were there in certain parts of the day and not other parts of the day, and some of them were related to others and others were different, and some came on at certain prime time periods and were repeated again and again. I mean, Google could crack that. It would just be doing statistical analysis and something would happen. So I don't think we're going to get away from that. I don't think our I Love Lucy is ever going to be mistaken for, you know, natural patterns of the universe. On the contrary.
Interesting.
If the Space Brothers show up, they're probably going to be bringing their Betamax recorders. They will have seen us.
Just really quickly, though, I'd say one thing, though, is I think if you look at the history of even anthropology, where you have the imperial origins of certain anthropological projects of going abroad and finding cultures that were either deemed worthy enough to interpret or not worthy enough to focus on. I think that you get a similar kind of thing where dolphins might not have TV, but then, you know, some tribe that is discovered in the mountains of Tibet or in the Amazon might not have representative democracy or bicameral legislatures, but it doesn't mean that their culture isn't worth deciphering or paying attention to. So I don't mean to suddenly say that, you know, we need to focus the conversation on dolphin intelligence, but I just think that there are other ways of exhibiting intelligence that don't necessarily give off signals or form information, kind of, Bruce, in the sense that you're talking about. And so I just wonder, though, what are the mechanisms that interpret those things that aren't electromagnetic and don't use radio waves? And, you know, is there an anthropology of star signals and that sort of thing? You know, there's a kind of a soft, I mean, you know, it's like the hard power of hardware versus the soft power of anthropological interpretation. And I just wonder which form of knowledge is the one that would be, you know, most interestingly explored as the genuine forefront of encountering the alien. Maybe it's not hardware at all. Maybe it's anthropology. Maybe it's, you know, speaking to undersea creatures through a hydrophone. Anyway.
Well, I'm keenly interested in the aliens. I'm not convinced they're an existential threat.
Mm-hmm.
Or even that our knowledge that there are other intelligent beings somewhere would be an existential threat. I think if we received an artificial message from another planet and we were aware that they were there, you know, many light years away, we'd be upset about it for a while, but then at the other time we'd sort of get along with it in a way that, like, this recent discovery of a possibly habitable Earth planet, you know, Gliese 81G or whatever the hell it is. And, you know, I mean, that's, like, caused some vague interest among people, but it hasn't really made us panic about, oh, well, there's another Earth out there. We've actually been pretty urbane about it. There's just libraries of science fiction written about this stuff, and a lot of, you know, SETI-style speculation, too. I mean, it's an interesting field of speculation, but I don't really find it particularly scary. I'm not really worried about aliens. You know, just, if they're there, they're there. And if there's one, I bet they'd be pretty much like mice. You know, if you find one, you're probably going to find 20. And the idea of finding 20 aliens is something that's, 20 different varieties of aliens is something that's poorly explored.
It goes back to the point that Davies is making in Eerie Silence, Paul Davies is making in his book The Eerie Silence, to wit that we have to be looking, he's arguing that we have to be looking in much more unconventional ways for the evidence of complex organization or alien intelligence, and not looking for Earth-like planets, for example, and not looking or listening for extremely high-energy intensive broadcasts, because those mechanisms are all born out of a paradigm coming out of the 50s and before. And we recognize that the sort of time frame, and I think, Bruce, you were talking about this a little while ago, the time frame of our technological ascendancy from pre-television to post-television is so short in comparison to the time frame over which a very complex civilization, if it survives, could evolve. That we're basically, as you put it, you said it would be like being in 1911 and trying to figure out a kind of a nuclear arms race problem. You just, it's beyond the epistemological horizon of the minds that are in that moment. And he's arguing that we need to try to think beyond that problem to see if there are actually intelligences that are absolutely non-anthropocentric. And again, it goes back to the point that Geoff was making a minute ago, but also the issue that Carl raised, Carl Chu. Raised in the audience, it seems to me that there's almost the potentiality that one would consider algorithms to be a class of machinic life, that the mathematician would look at algorithms and complex mathematical relationships as quasi-lifelike entities, which then do have a whole set of rules, axiomatic rules, which allow them to, one, to exist and to propagate themselves through many different regimes of matter and relationship, but two, to have a kind of an intelligence. It's just not the intelligence that we have. You know, Kubrick, when he was making 2001, was interviewed, and the interviewer was asking him about his idea about what aliens would really be like, and Kubrick straight away said, you know, there's absolutely no reason why they would exist in the same time scale that we exist within. A million-year journey for them might be like us going on a road trip for a weekend or a month. And we really have to think much beyond the kind of usual anthropocentric limits. That's one of the subplots that I read in the comment that Carl was making, that we would identify intelligence and we would identify structure in ways that are absolutely outside of what we usually tend to identify them from an anthropocentric perspective as. I mean, it runs the risk of apophenia, which is this cryptologist's, you know, kind of mania for seeing pattern in everything. You know, and I think we have to, I don't know, maybe celebrate apophenia. Maybe that's the joy of this whole project, is to see that there is meaning and pattern in everything, you know, that the very fabric of being is in communication with itself in every way it possibly can be, and that's the intelligence that's the intelligence, certainly on some level, that authors like Raisin and Garastani are speculating about, trying to identify where those different classes of intelligence exist.
Yeah. Well, something there really quickly that I think is interesting is the idea, is precisely that idea of timescale. And we assume, for instance, that an alien civilization exists and thinks at the same time, so that an I Love Lucy episode is the same time frame as their daylight or what they experience at the present moment. But I mean, we could also imagine a situation where, say, there's a 500 million year long neutrino storm, and we're experiencing it right now, and it'll last for another 499 million years, and that's the first blimp, or the first blip in a very long code that will last billions of years.
Mm-hmm.
And there's no way you can possibly interpret that with our hardware or our lifespan or anything. There's no way that we could see the signal through to completion. And so I think those kinds of things are also really provocative. But to go back really, really quickly again, I think that I just want to disagree about if we see that the idea of aliens will be like mice, and then if we see one, there will be 20. And I'm trying to think of a metaphor for that. I mean, imagine something like, you know, anthropologists in the year 1890 setting off on a ship to go to Papua New Guinea and saying, oh, do you think we'll meet any people over there with any ideas or any intelligence? And says, if we meet one, we'll meet 20. And I guess I feel like there's an anthropological political and interpretive lessons from anthropology that I think could be useful in the search for alien life, in the sense that you know, what we would overlook as intelligence from our standpoint might be very, very intelligent from another one, but we have certain class or political or communicative biases that we need to overcome. And anyway, all of these things I think are really, really interesting, especially when applied to the realm of even algorithms and mathematics. Because if you take the sort of ideological problems of anthropology as a discipline, and you apply it to things like almost the way that Manuel de Landa or even Carl Chu would apply to computer intelligence, I think you get into some really, really interestingly problematic areas where you get into speciations of alienness that may be completely unintelligible if you do look at it from the standpoint of, as you've just been saying, anthropocentric or human-based, what we consider intelligent timescales.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think we have cultural vogues in our ideas of what are alien. And generally they flatter us in some way, because that's easy to dramatize, and we use aliens as a kind of funhouse mirror of ourselves. There's, you know, a long tradition of really alien aliens. Like, I think the first contact, alien contact story ever written, I believe it was Camille Flammarion. They're a crystalline form that sort of arrives on Earth, and just, you know, they're sort of like giant salt crystals, and they don't want to talk to us, and they don't want anything to do with us, and they just don't have arms and legs and can't ever be negotiated with. They're just other. But those, you know, things of that kind, or the kind of temporary displaced aliens that you were talking about, Geoff, are hard to dramatize, and they really never caught on with the public. And on the contrary, you can sort of see waves of aliens. It's like, okay, you know, in times of war, the aliens are invaders. And at other periods, the aliens are stand-ins for racial problems or gender issues whatever it is, that they can be used as kind of, dramatic puppets to deal with. You know, and new understandings in physics tend to come up with new kinds of aliens. It's like you get the idea of aliens on very cold planets after a while, when, you know, physicists have come up with things. I would imagine there's going to be a few of these Titan aliens, of the ones that deposit as an amino acid layer. And I would predict, you know, I don't know how long this is going to take, but really, there's a new cosmology which is all about dark energy and dark matter, in which the stuff we consider to be energy and matter is actually 4% of the cosmos. Okay, if that's true, you know, and this, it's like a serious astrophysical speculation, I mean, 96% of everything is just totally other.
who owns that stuff? Well, it is a tremendous, more like pond scum compared to, you know, this completely unknown and untouchable realm of dark energy and dark matter. Hey, you know, people deal with the astrophysics, say, hey.
Now we're going back to H.P. Lovecraft, right? And the Elder Gods. The entire region.
I guess, Lovecraft was into cosmic horror. He thought we should be really afraid of a thing like that. Mm-hmm. I don't know if our civilization, it's a Copernican dethroning of us to sort of say we're 4% of the universe and 96% of it is just darkness that we can never approach. Mm-hmm. But it wouldn't surprise me necessarily that should happen, because it's like, well, it is Copernican, it's just we continually learn things about ourselves through science that are humiliating. And just, we're not the center of the universe, we're off in a corner of the universe, the world is much older than us, much, much older than us, it wasn't made for us, it wasn't created for us, we're not as old as the world. And the latest vogue is this odd thing going on where people are supposed to respect their interior microbes. So you're kind of like a new meme, 90% other kinds of alien life inside your body. Why aren't you kinder to your intestinal flora? We've always had intestinal flora, so what we're seeing here is a new sensibility. And you can probably make yourself healthier by staying away from antibiotics, taking probiotics, etc. That would not surprise me at all if that was by the middle of our century. That was just absolute medical common sense. You're mostly things that aren't human. Be nice to them. Accept your non-humanity. It wouldn't be any odder than like a toleration of gay marriage, really. It's something of a stretch, but not something that we couldn't get our heads around.
Well, we're sitting here in Los Angeles, and I know that the high colonic has always been in vogue in Los Angeles. So one could assume that out here on the western shores, there's been a very special relationship with the bacterial flora for a number of years.
Well, it's one of those cosmeceutical things that wouldn't surprise me to see engineered to do, and it's a design problem.
Yeah,
it's probably legal to eat a lot of odd stuff, and, eat living organisms of various kinds. There's a market drive to do it. If you had one that secreted Viagra, people would immediately line up to take it. If you could rub live germs into your face and they could remove wrinkles as effectively as Botox, obviously that would be a big seller. There would be some reaction to it at first, but it would just be obliterated by the public demand. It just, it's easy to forecast. It's not a hard thing.
This is a kind of a future horizon like Warren Ellis envisions in Transmetropolitan, which I think, Bruce, you must be familiar with. Yeah, that.
I'm quite the Warren Ellis fan. I mean, Warren is a satirist, and quite commonly, satirists are extremely foresightful because they're picking on weak spots in society and things that are apparent absurdities or that make people laugh. People laugh at them, in fact, because they are plausible. Because they touch some kind of inner need to go and do that kind of stuff. And I also like Warren's thinking a lot because he hangs out with designers I take seriously.
Mm-hmm.
Warren is sort of like a comic book visionary in residence over at Berg, the British Experimental Rocket Group, who are big and interaction designer guys in Silicon Roundabout in London. So that's a rare example of a guy from a science fiction popular culture thing who's directly tied in with some pretty heavy duty design people doing really kind of extrapolative thinking. And clearly he brings something to the table there because they're keen to be able to have conclaves with Warren. I'm happy when things like that happen. I mean, not everybody can really contribute to that discourse, but the silos are breaking these fields of creative practice, and there are some people who can really kind of make it happen.
So maybe that's part of the design and existential risk solution. I don't want to end on a positive note because I don't intuitively feel like it's
not a real positive thing to confront.
It's true. It's true. So we're gonna be confronting it over and over again for the next 2 months. The kind of relentlessness of an impending doom. Is there anyone else there in the audience who wants to float a question before we wrap up?
One more question. You spoke rather strongly earlier about how design in a totalitarian culture like East Germany affects the quality of the design. Later, you spoke a bit about our militaristic response to 9/11 in terms that could be interpreted as somewhat totalitarian. We're still dealing with the aftermath of that, and I'm wondering, do you think that that's affected the quality of design here in the States, and if so, how?
Well, it certainly affected urbanity in the United States. I mean, one of the major design interventions after 9/11 was the Jersey barrier, which is just all over the place. I mean, we're just blockaded out of our own cities. And of course, we have the design of the TSA, the transportation safety people, which, you know, basically require us to remove our shoes and submit to ritual humiliation over and over and over and over again. And, you know, somebody had to design that. Somebody designed the RFID chips that went into our passports. They designed the entire, you know, app. State, and it's there. I mean, it's not everywhere, but you know, the idea that one gets over that, it doesn't really happen. I mean, we're still living with the consequences of Nazi design. I mean, you know, Nazi uniforms are super popular and really great design. You know, they're just visually striking and they're kind of gorgeous, and you know, they strongly appeal to generation after generation. I mean, you don't really see anybody in French World War II uniforms. That was, you know, Speer and Hitler, who was a graphic designer, you know, and painter as well as a dictator. So, you know, I think it's important to study design work and also fiction and just art works of other totalitarian states. I mean, I spent a lot of time in Eastern Europe where the relics of totalitarianism were all over the landscape. And there are areas of totalitarian design that were really modern, especially Italy, where I spent a lot of time. I mean, futurism was born in Italy, and it was fascist. It was a fascist movement. And, you know, people like to think that, oh, well, they're artsy and they were like really cool graphic designers, so they weren't really fascist. Sorry. They were really fascist. I mean, really, really fascist and really good designers. So, you know, and we haven't gotten over that. I mean, it's the centenary of futurism. And to sort of think that creative skills exempt you from the evil intent of your paymasters is foolishness. And not only that, but there are inherent political implications in design design interventions in other people's lives. The architectural is political, and, you know, the graphic is political, deconstruction is political, political graphic design is all over the landscape, and choosing to help one group over another has moral, ethical, legal, and political implications. And design isn't any more exempt from that than architecture or novel writing or musicians or philosophy or any other creative. So, you know, I take a special interest in areas of design that cannot be sold. Because it's very easy to write about something people will buy. You will be paid to write about it. But that's not what actually happened through design in our society. That's not really the legacy we're dealing with, and we need to make special efforts to look for stuff. In order to understand your own discipline, you need to make special efforts to look at stuff that just is not okay. I mean, this is like not recuperable and not openly spoken about. Because that's where the bodies are buried, and that's where you learn from failure. I mean, experience is what you have when you're looking for something else. And you want to learn
you want to learn from other people's mistakes to the extent that you can so as to avoid repeating. And a little humility never hurts.
Is that it on your guys' side?
I think so.
Yeah?
Does anyone else have any other questions? There is one more question. That's okay. I mean, we're running right on the edge of time. It's just 8:45.
Yeah. Let's take one more question and then wrap up. Yeah.
I'll make a plug. I think everybody ought to see this projection mapping incident that's about to happen over at the Video Fest. I've never seen projection mapping instead of augmented reality intervention. These guys from CEPR, they're some of the best in the world. If they can get all that hardware to boot at 10 p.m., they're going to like run it here. This is very cutting edge. I mean, this is like beyond the beyond. These are some of the best practitioners in the field who are about to go out and blast this building over on 14th Street, 18th Street. 18th Street,
yeah,
18, whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah, this Frank Gehry building, the ICA headquarters, this ought to be a hoot. It's going to be pretty heavy duty.
It's 10 p.m.? 10 p.m. your time?
Yes, yep. I'm going. Wouldn't miss it for the world.
All right, one more question. You touched upon ontology earlier on, evolution in terms of like interpretation, but coming from nothing in fantasy sci-fi, especially when you go into the chapter, it seems to me that I'm wondering about your thoughts about not political engineering, but cultural engineering, where we can use that to kind of an intellectual kind of.
Well, I mean, there are a lot of people who have been into perfect humanity, and a lot of them are fascists. I read an interesting thing quite recently about German popular publications. I mean, there was a lot of German pulp magazine publications in the 1920s and 1930s. They really had a pretty lively scene, and you know, among that were science fiction magazines, mostly about space travel and so forth, kind of, you know, the popular face of von Braun. And as Goebbels took over as Minister of Propaganda, he began, imposing more and more rules on popular fiction, you know, until eventually the entire field of cultural expression in Germany was lobotomized and basically turned into a giant arm of the state. But interestingly, the genres that responded to Goebbels, the people who refused to collaborate were the mystery magazines. And the science fiction magazines were thrilled. It's like, Goebbels, hey, you're our guy. And I was like, von Braun, man, more rockets. We were like, put this all the way. And I was like, the future. Whereas the mystery people knew that a crime was being committed. I mean, that is my theory. They just smelled a rat, you know, and they refused to go there because they had more street smarts than sci-fi people. You know, and as a science fiction writer, you know, I was a little alarmed to read that, but it did not surprise me overly. You know, Nazi ideas were, they had big sci-fi tinges. I mean, the V2 rocket, for heaven's sake. If they'd only knocked it off of the V2 rocket and just built more artillery, they probably could have crushed the Allies at Normandy. But they had to have this supersonic vengeance weapon because it was just so high-tech and sleek and kind of German designery, and they defeated themselves through that effort. I mean, practically every country that's had a space program has gone broke and fallen apart, starting with Nazi Germany, working through the Russians, and we're not looking too hot ourselves. So, you know, it's good to know your spiritual ancestors, especially the embarrassing.
Okay, so let me just say thank you to Elizabeth for introducing, if she's still there, I hope she's still there, and Carla for moderating in New York and responding, and Bruce, thank you so much for coming, and Geoff Manaugh, thank you for hosting the Los Angeles side, and Nicola Twilley is here also for hosting us here on the West side, and to the audience for listening to us speculate wildly for almost 3 hours straight on the fact that, that we may not have any future really at all.
That was good clicking.
And thanks to Ed as well for putting all this together.
Sure.
So congrats.
Sure.
So if you guys are interested in this event, it's in the IAC.